हेलो
हेलो,
हेलो, नॉट गेटिंग साउंड। हेलो, गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी। आई वेलकम यू ऑल फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, नेताजी सुभाष महाविद्यालय उदयपुर। टुडे वी आर हियर टू डिस्कस लॉट ऑन न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी 2020। Our program is entitled Understanding National Education Policy 2020, An Evening with the Intellectuals. And we are really happy that we have got so many intellectuals today with us. And it's going to be a very interesting sort of series. Earlier also we had conducted from our college an international webinar that was on partition. But since the federal government of India on July 29, they announced a new education policy to promote education among people of India. This policy covers elementary education to colleges in both rural and urban India. So that's why, since it's a very important sort of thing and which is going to revolutionize the education sector in our country, that's why we deemed it proper to hold such a lecture series. Hopefully, it would be participated by lots of people like you. And we have got among us today some of the most celebrated academicians from this country, from this part of the part of Northeast India, and as well as our very own our Honorable Education Minister, who is also holding the charge of Minister of Higher Education as well. He will be there, and it would be nice to hear what he feels about this education policy. And mind it, this is the third national policy on education. The first one was promulgated in 1968 by the government of Prime Minister, the then Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, the second by Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi in 1986, which was later modified by the next Prime Minister, that is P.V. Narasimha Rao government in 1992. And after that, after 34 years, we have got a new policy, which is aiming to bring about a revolution in our education system. So it has several promises to keep and appears to be timely in several regards. The new education policy, which is in short NEP, is both visionary and ambitious. Much of its success will depend on its execution. So we have got a lot with us, our principal in charge, Madam Dr. Rita Das Naik. She'll be talking something about this lecture series, how it has come about and what is her idea and her welcome address, you can say, welcome address to this lecture series. Over to our principal in charge, Madam Dr. Rita Das Naik, who has been an inspiration for all of us. She has been egging us all to promote this sort of workshop, this sort of lecture series, this sort of webinars also. Over to you, Madam Dr. Rita Das Naik. Hello, Madam. So it has been a long wait, and we are also actually proud that it is for the first time in some educational institute we are organizing this lecture series on national education policy. This is the first time in the country, and that's why it's a fair thing to say that we have taken the the first step towards understanding this national education policy. So before we proceed further, let me tell you that our college, Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya at Udaipur, has been conducting so many workshops and seminars on different sort of topics, and national education policy is one of them. Today, in this evening, we are having right now a talk from Dr. Rita Das Naik, who would be welcoming all of us. So over to you, Madam. We're waiting for the connectivity. So the federal government on July 29th, as you all know, that our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, he has announced the new education policy, and it is basically aimed at revolutionizing the regular concept of education among people of India. And there are lots of interesting things, starting from the elementary sector to the PG sector, and research ideas, how the policy is going to affect us in every way. We are going to listen to the intellectuals today, which comprises some of the important names of this part, and starting with our education minister, Mr. Ratanlal Nath, and then we'll have a member from UGC, the apex body of education right now. He'll be Professor Kiran Hajarika. Then we'll have Professor Anup Kumar De, who is head of the department, Assam University, Diffu campus, followed by school principal. We have got Ravans Tripura Vidyamandir here in Agartala. So there, in that school, we have got the principal, Mrs. Shapna Shom, who will be talking about school education. And after that, we'll have Dr. Shorit Bhattacharya, who is a professor at University of Glasgow. So there, we'll be talking, right now we'll be dissecting the National Education Policy, we'll say, through this lecture series. So before we go to the intellectuals, let me introduce our principal madam of Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Dr. Rita Das Nayak. She'll be giving our welcome address to all. Over to you, madam.
Thank you. I am very happy to meet you all in the evening, where a galaxy of intellectuals have come together in connection with a discussion organized by the Department of English in collaboration with IQAC SAIL of Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Udaipur, Tripura, India. The topic is Understanding New Education Policy 2020, and Evening with the Intellectuals. In this webinar, I heartily welcome our Honorable Education Minister, Mr. Ratanlal Nath, whose dynamic thinking and evergreen energies are the benchmark of our endeavor to engulf into the enthusiasm to do something innovative work. I convey my namaskar to you, sir. I cordially welcome our Director of Higher Education, Government of Tripura, Mr. Saju Bahir, whose constant support and cooperation rejuvenate us to foster a dream of doing something innovative. I deeply acknowledge you, sir. We have with us Professor Kiran Hajarika, Member UGC, Government of India. I feel honored to welcome you in this webinar, sir. I hope your thought-provoking ideas will widen our horizon of knowledge. I again welcome you, sir. We have with us Dr. Anup Kumar De, Head, Department of English, Assam University. Your valuable presence is appreciated in this webinar. I welcome you heartily. We have with us Dr. Shorit Bhattacharya, Assistant Professor, Department of English, University of Glasgow, UK. I feel excited to listen to the academician hailing from different time zones. I welcome cordially. I have with us Mrs. Shapna Shom, Principal Bhavans Tripura Vidyamandir Agartala. I welcome you and feel proud to get perception from a principal who is actively involved in shaping young minds. I welcome all the participants of this webinar and wish a grand success of the webinar. The new education policy 2020 announced by MHRD aims at making the education system holistic, flexible, multidisciplinary, and aligned to the needs of 21st century. The significance of national education policy lies in recognizing importance of formative year, departure from silos mentality, that is, the division of arts, science, and commerce stream. The introduction of vocational course with an internship, that is the confluence of education and skills, etc. The light but tight approach will be highlighted, and I strongly believe that a paper is primarily rough and has corners and different edges. But while it rolls down at the bottom of the river, its edges are worn away and its rough surfaces are made smooth and shiny. Likewise, multiple attitude, various discussion, arguments, analysis, encompassing all the angles and corners of the policy and interthinking will aid this new education policy to bloom up with its two fragments. Quoting Rabindranath Tagore, I can say, it is a truism to say that shadows accompany light. Facts can easily be arranged and heaped up into loads of contradiction. Yet men, having faith in the reality of ideas, hold firmly that the vision of truth does not depend on its dimension, but upon its vitality. So I think today's discussion will enlighten us about the new education policy for which we are progressing, and we are waiting eagerly the success of this new education policy. And I hope a grand success of this webinar. And I am proud and privileged to have with us so young galaxies of intellectuals. So thank you so much. I again welcome you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam, for your words. You have always been an inspiration for us. And with your able leadership, I hope that our college will be reaching new sort of heights also. Thank you very much for coming to the webinar. Now, we are supposed to hear to our director, Saju Wahid, who is an IAS, he's director of higher education department, but somehow he is not there and we are not getting his connection. And therefore, we'll be going straight away to our Education Minister, Mr. Ratanlal Nath, who over the years, over the last 2 or 3 years, has been doing tremendously well for the welfare of this Department of Education in our state of Tripura. So, Mr. Ratanlal Nath, who is also a lawyer by profession, and he has brought some interesting changes in the school education in our state, where he had tried his best to bring forward the underprivileged section of the students, and he has done a lot to uplift the quality of our education in our state. So we are very happy, we are very privileged to have amongst us our Honorable Education Minister, and he will be delivering right now, and we'll be getting to know what sir says about new education policy and what is his idea, what is his attitude about new education policy. Over to you, sir. A very good evening to you, sir. And it's all over to you. And we want to hear you. We are actually eagerly waiting for our education minister to highlight on the important issues. What is his idea? What are the perceptions that are going on in his mind? And what are his plannings for our state of Tripura? We are all enthusiastically listening to him. Over to you, sir. Thank you very much for coming. It is over to you, sir.
Good evening,
You hear me?
Yes, sir. You are perfectly audible.
Good evening, everybody. I am extremely delighted to be voicing my opinions on this virtual platform on New Education Policy 2020. That the Department of English, Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Udaipur, Tripura, India, has taken the first initiative in the country to enlighten all about NEP gives me joy and satisfaction. I congratulate the organizers of this lecture issue series and the college authority for such a timely webinar. The federal government on July 29 announced the new education policy to promote education among people of India. The policy covers elementary education to colleges in both rural and urban India. After 34 years, we have a new policy that aims to bring about a revolution in our education system. It has several promises to keep and appears to be timely in several regards. National Education Policy, or NEP, is both visionary and ambitious. Much of its success will depend on its execution. It aims for national integration through education that enables our students to actualize their potentials and appears to be sufficiently open and flexible to embrace the journey of all. One of its strengths is its multidisciplinary and availability of choice-based pursuits to the students at the level of the school. This has opened several entry points and exit points for the students within the system. It has also tried to overcome the prevailing insularity in subjects of specialization in higher education and opened seamless pursuits of science, arts, and humanities. To allow this to happen, it has radically transformed the entire structure of our education. The present 10 plus 2 system is replaced by 5-3-3-4 in school education. The previous system had overly linearized education and did not accommodate the different needs of the students. The present choice-based system opens the play field for the students, and it is not just linear, but is also horizontal. These flexi possibilities that allow the pursuits of vocational and non-vocational subjects alongside co-curricular and extracurricular activities may reduce school dropouts. And multiple points of entry will make it easy for some dropouts to enter the system. By and large, the NEP seems to be guided by the findings of neuroscience. The streamlining of preschool education is a welcome move and has rightly proposed activity-based, play-based, and discover-based pedagogies for our children. Besides, it has bravely kept the medium of instruction to the choice of the student, as India in the 21st century mostly have multilingual student communities in our urban areas and is increasingly becoming similar in our rural areas. This has irked some imperialists of the vernaculars who like to impose local languages on the poor while the rich are allowed to educate themselves in private schools to gain proficiency in English. English has become a language of social mobility and becomes a link language to a multilingual nation.
the multidisciplinary approach that is introduced at the school level is continued at higher education and is clearly aligned to the global system. This approach opens possibilities of bringing research focus into our institutions of higher education. With this focus, the 3 years of graduation has been upgraded to 4 years. This move has been made to scrap MPhil and allow possibilities of pursuing PhD program after a master's degree. All in all, one can trace that a clear student-centric approach inscribed in the entire system and appears to make room for critical thinking. Holistic approach, inquiry-based, discovery-based, discussion-based, and analysis-based learning. Besides, it embraces new modes of evaluations to overcome rote learning, where assimilation of concepts and their applications are emphasized. Besides, exams are introduced in class 3, 5, 10, and 12, which are said to lead the students to test their strengths and make wise choices of discipline they wish to pursue. The policy aims to create a robust digital infrastructure in the education sector that ensures uninterrupted learning even during unprecedented circumstances. The National Education Technology Forum will be established for ensuring that the technology is integrated adequately and efficiently in the education process and ensuring the enhancement of the access of education to all sections of the society, even in these tumultuous times. Various contours of the society, of this policy, aim to radically improve the gross enrollment ratio in higher education and to achieve the objective of 100% youth literacy. Moreover, the said policy has also been predicted to reduce social and economic gap between students, which has magnified in wake of this pandemic. The contours of NEP is expected to revise the regulatory avatar of the Higher Education Commission of India, being set up with a wide role in Indian higher education. The HECI is likely to have 4 verticals under its umbrella, including 1, National Higher Education Regulatory Council, intended to be a single point regulator for the higher education sector. 2, National Accreditation Council, which will deal with accreditation of institutions. 3 is Higher Education Grant Council, which will be tasked with carrying out funding and financing of higher education. And 4 is General Education Council. The final vertical is expected to have a more academic-based role, as it will frame expected learning outcomes for higher education programs. As far as the state of Tripura is concerned, we are in favor of a holistic approach of NEP 2020. The implementation of such sweeping change is a challenge, and this will take place in consultation with all stakeholders. It has been clearly stated that the state government will be consulted and their views would be taken care of. The policy is nothing like imposition, as is being erroneously perceived by some corners. The state of Tripura, under the able leadership of the Chief Minister Biplab Kumar Deb, aims to increase gross enrollment ratio of the students from the present about 25% to 50% in the next 10 years time. In the last 2 years, massive steps have been taken by the state government in order to enhance the quality of education in the state, like adherence to CBSE syllabus, transparent teacher recruitment process, centralized question paper, Nutun Disha for learning gap students, amalgamation of nearest school, and starting spoken English course, special drive to elevate the standard of the academically backward students, etc. A regional institute of education will be set up. A Sainik is also coming up. We are committed to establish a school as a center of excellence and a degree college as a center of excellence in the state. Other institutions will emulate these centers of excellence. Employability is a major issue now in education sector. Keeping this in mind, we have introduced vocational courses in three subjects: electronics and hardware, agriculture, and IT. Efforts are being taken in primary, secondary, and tertiary sectors to ensure that the state of Tripura in the coming years will produce job creators, not job seekers. Student-teacher ratio is also a factor to be dealt with, and therefore, recruitment of teachers, merger of schools, etc., will be taken up with caution and immediacy. One must keep this in mind that the policies cannot be implemented overnight. As we all know, Rome was not built in a day. But one time, I can assure you all that this government will not leave any stone unturned in revolutionizing the educational sector in this state with utmost integrity and sincerity, as has been exemplified in heaps of praise bestowed upon the state government by the central government for implementing NCRT mode here. We have taken serious note on NEP 2020, and hence we already formed yesterday a task force committee in order to streamline, strategize, materialize the necessary changes as and when this appear. Thank you all. Jai Hind.
Excellent. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your thoughtful deliberation. We are really happy that you have planned a lot and you are not lagging behind in implementation of these ideas. National Education Policy 2020 is not a new thing for our state of Tripura with your able leadership. And we are happy that in the days to come, the government is really sincere and trying their best to implement all the good results that would be coming up from New Education Policy 2020. Thank you very much, sir, for coming to this webinar. And we all are happy that you have spared your valuable time for this webinar. Thank you once again, sir, very much. Now we'll be proceeding to our next speaker, who is a member of University Grants Commission. He is a member of the Apex body, Professor Kiran Hajarika. Presently, he is working as a principal in Khenka Ghat College in Assam, and he is principal for more than 10 years. And besides, he is a professor of Hindi, and his books are being studied in several sort of universities. And he is an important member of our highest body of higher education, that is University Grants Commission. Professor Kiran Hajarika, he had earlier also visited this state of Tripura for a seminar. And Professor Hajarika is a known face in our country for his excellent, lectureship, for his excellent erudition in national education policy. We are extremely thankful to you, sir, for that you have come here and you have agreed to deliver a lecture on new education policy. It is all yours, sir, right now. And hum log Hindi mein sunna chahte hain, sir, because we have got our listeners from all across the country. So Hindi mein bolne se there would be much greater reach, that I understand. Thank you very much for coming. It is all over to you, sir. So we are going to listen to Professor Kiran Hazarika, the member of University Grants Commission, Government of India. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Surajit Sen. And today is Netaji Subhash Chandra Bosu Mahavidyalaya. Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, shortly, Udaipur. You are organizing international lecture series, and especially this subject today you selected, that is new education policy, National Education Policy 2020. All over the country, it is being discussed in every educational institutions, all the stakeholders. Especially, I'm going to thank you that you are inviting me to participate and interact with such a trending topic, that is NEP 2020. I just heard the minister, Professor Ratan Lal Nath sir. So he is education minister of Tripura government. So unko maine suna hai. Aur Saju Wahid IAS officer, he is also presenting today, director of higher education Tripura. And the next one, Saudit Bhattacharya ji, he is from University of Glasgow. He is also today going to present here. And Arup Kumar De, Dr. Arup Kumar De is from Assam University, Department of English, also participating. And so many followers are watching through YouTube and StreamYard. I welcome all of you that you are today hearing a big and nice topic, that is NEP. तो स्पेशली दिस एनईपी मुझे तो बताया गया कि आप हिंदी में बोलो तो ठीक है मैं थोड़ा हिंदी भी कोशिश करूंगा हिंदी में भी बोलूंगा और अभी हम थोड़ा जाएंगे कि जो एनईपी से पहले भारत में कितने कमीशंस ऑन एजुकेशन बना था सो इसमें देखेंगे कि हमारा जो तीन कमीशन या चार कमीशन इससे पहले भारत में हुआ था आफ्टर पोस्ट इंडिपेंडेंस सो वन वाज द फर्स्ट इट वाज कम इनटू फोर्स इन 1940 एंड 49 आफ्टर इमीडिएटली इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ इंडिया दैट इज यूनिवर्सिटी एजुकेशन कमीशन इनिशियली दैट कमीशन वाज डिजाइन बाय द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट एट दैट टाइम ऑल्दो दिस गवर्नमेंट वाज कम टू फोर्स इन फ्रॉम 1950 But one interim government was formed by the Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru. So the second education commission, that is for initially the university grant commission, university education commission formed, and secondly the secondary education commission for the secondary education that was also come into force in 1952 and 53. And thirdly, another one commission, that commission was broadly discussed and very impactful one commission was formed, that is called Kothari Commission also, but D.S. Kothari was chairman of this committee, namely not Kothari Commission, but it is come to know that there is Kothari Commission, and mainly the Education Commission, that was in 1964. And the fourthly, the National Knowledge Commission, that was in 2009, coming to force in that central government. Two major policy, education policy. This education policy after 1986, after a long period, almost three decades passing over, and we are now getting one very fruitful education policy that is called NEP 2020. Earlier this NEP, there are two education policy also designed by the, and designed and came into force in Indian Republic The first one, the national national policy on education. That was a first policy in 1968. It was come into force. And secondly, the national policy on education. It was, that is the 1986. This is big policy. Under this policy, all these Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, Uchchatra Shiksha Abhiyan, and totally education, especially in primary education, lot of changes was done. Although, but targeted to achieve the goal to 100% child education to achieve, but couldn't achieve. Even after the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, we have left out 2 crore child without education. So it is a big issue. Therefore, this NEP is a very important NEP. One Kasturi Rangan committee, okay, Kasturi Rangan committee, he was chairman. One committee was formed in 2017, and especially central government are trying from to establish one new education policy in India, because it is needed. Because still after 34 years old policy we are enforcing. So the time is changed. Ab samay badal gaya hai. Samay ke saath hame ab is desh education ya nayi shiksha niti ki avashyakta thi. Isliye to in shiksha niti ko hum kaise lagu kiya jaye, to iske liye ये प्रयास किया गया था, और 1915 से इसके बारे में चर्चा शुरू हो गई थी सरकार के अंदर, और चलते चलते 2017 को ये कमेटी बनाई गई, और के कस्तूरी रंगन कमेटी, ही वाज फॉर्मरली आईसीएसआर डायरेक्टर, वन टॉप मोस्ट साइंटिस्ट एंड एजुकेशनिस्ट. सो this committee has submitted its their draft policy on December 2018, and this 2019 January in February, especially February, it was published by the central government, that for the public suggestion, ki taki puri public ko ye choda gaya hai, aur isme taki student ka kya view hai, तो बाकी एकेडमिशियंस का, जो शिक्षाविद है उनका है, तो छात्रों देश के हर कोने कोने में, इवन 1,25,000 ग्राम सेवकों के पास भी ये विषय गया है, तो कि उनके पास से भी ताकि रिकमेंडेशन है. और लगभग जून 30 का इनका 2019 तक इनका टाइम वो सजेशन इनपुट कर सकता है. इस बार से देखा है कि मोर देन 2 lakh सजेशंस वर इनपुट बाय द स्टेक होल्डर्स लाइक स्टूडेंट्स, एकेडमिशियंस, प्रोफेसर्स, एंड इवन 1,25,000 ग्राम सेवक आल्सो इन पुट देयर कमेंट थ्रू ऑनलाइन. सो मोर देन 2 lakh द एमएचआरडी मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ ह्यूमन रिसोर्स डेवलपमेंट प्रेजेंटली इट इज बिकम one gazette notification the day after day before yesterday published by the central government president of India, that now the MHRD, the Ministry of Human Resource Department, become only as a minister of education, ministry of education is shiksha mantralay. Abhi shiksha mantralay ने इसको अभी हम बोलेंगे शिक्षा मंत्रालय में 2 lakh से अधिक जो सजेशंस आया उनको देखते फिर वो कस्तूरी रंजन कमेटी को दिया गया, उन्होंने फिर इसको कंपाइलेशन करके फिर सरकार को सबमिट किया है. और सरकार ने जो 29 जुलाई इस पिछले महीने 29 जुलाई को ये घोषित कर दिया गया है कि भारत में एक नई शिक्षा नीति लागू हो गई, एनएपी. तो स्पेशली मैं थोड़ा आई एम गोइंग टू से सम कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ दिस पॉलिसी, कि इसकी वैशिष्टता ही क्या है, कि हम इसको थोड़ा ध्यान से देने से हम थोड़ा एजुकेशन पॉलिसी पर नहीं जाएंगे, लेकिन हम कुछ इसकी वैशिष्टताएं पर हम बताएंगे. जैसे ये स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली, फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द कंट्री it is reacted that it is a student friendly policy forever. इससे पहले ये कभी नहीं था कि स्टूडेंट को ज्यादा ध्यान में रखा गया है. स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली कैसे हैं, अब स्टूडेंट को कोई भी सब्जेक्ट चॉइस करने की सुविधा है, स्टूडेंट को मातृभाषा में पढ़ने की सुविधा है, तो स्टूडेंट को अपने एक एकेडमिक क्रेडिट बैंकिंग सिस्टम हो गया है जिसमें आप कुछ भी एक्टिविटी यू कैन डू एप एनी एक्टिविटी, कुछ भी गतिविधि आप करो, चाहे आप खेलो कूदो या आप पढ़ो या कुछ भी करो, आप घर में कुछ स्किल का कोई सामान, आप यू हैव द स्किल नॉलेज, आपके पास वो ज्ञान है और इसको आप यू आर गोइंग टू यूटिलाइज दिस स्किल. मान लीजिए आप सिलाई बुनाई से लेकर कुछ भी करो घर में, एम्ब्रॉयडरी भी अगर गर्ल्स करती है उसकी भी एक उनको एकेडमिक क्रेडिट बैंक सिस्टम में उनको क्रेडिट मिलता है. तो इसके लिए घर में रहो चाहे बाहर रहो कहीं भी रहो, तो यू हैव टू बिजी योरसेल्फ इन सम एक्टिविटीज, इट मे बी एकेडमिक और सम अदर एकेडमिक एक्टिविटी. सो ऑल आर कम इन हिज और हर क्रेडिट. सो इसीलिए इतना स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली पॉलिसी है. मान लीजिए आप डिग्री में भी इस प्रकार से स्टूडेंट्स आ सकता है जा सकता है, मल्टी एंट्रीज की सुविधा है, मल्टी एग्जिट्स की सुविधा है, तो इसीलिए इट इज कॉल्ड दैट इंडो दैट इज स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली पॉलिसी कि स्टूडेंट को पूरी आज़ादी है, रिसर्च तक आज़ादी है, आप लोकल इशूज पर आप रिसर्च कर सकते हैं किसी भी. मान लीजिए त्रिपुरा में आपकी चाय बागान, आपके पास रबर बागान है तो रबर पर हो सकता है, आपके पास वो जलाशय है जलाशय पर काम, उदयपुर में इतना बड़ा जलाशय है, झील है इतना बड़ा, तो इसमें रिसर्च कर सकते हैं. तो इन सब तमाम लोकल इश्यूज पर यू कैन सो रिसर्च इनोवेशन गुजरे. और इस पॉलिसी का तीन प्रिंसिपल हैं. पहला प्रिंसिपल है कि इक्विटी इन एन इनोवेशन, इक्विटी इंक्लूशन. तो आप इक्विटी को किस प्रकार से एक सामाजिक समरसता जिसको कहा जाता है, इस पॉलिसी में ज़रा ध्यान गया है. बहुत सारे कुछ सम एकेडमिशियन सम कमिंग फ्रॉम सम बैकग्राउंड, तो कुछ हो सकता है सवाल करते हैं कि इक्विटी नहीं है ये बिल्कुल इसमें पूरा जैसे धनिक श्रेणी का ही कुछ होगा, प्राइवेटाइजेशन की ओर जा रहा है, ऐसी कोई बात नहीं है. इसलिए ये बिल्कुल क्या है, ये बिल्कुल इक्विटी, सोशल इक्विटी को ध्यान, इसका प्रिंसिपल है. सो समाज के हर एक क्षेत्र से, हमारे एक इस्लाम से लेकर एक बहुत बड़े धनी व्यक्ति के बेटा का भी एजुकेशन सिस्टम विल बी सेम, सबको समान तरह का ही सुविधा मिलेगा. इसीलिए जो अभी हमारे मिनिस्टर साहब ने बोला है कि द एजुकेशन पैटर्न हैज बीन चेंज, पैटर्न चेंज हो गया, जैसे 10+2 था पहले, अभी क्या 5+3+3+4, यानी हमें अभी इस 12 आपको 10 से आपको ये 18 साल में एक क्या है, एक बच्चे को पूरी हम तैयारी करेंगे कि एक देश के भविष्य नागरिक के रूप में तैयारी करेंगे. सो इंडोसेंट्रिक इसका नेक्स्ट है कि इंडोसेंट्रिक है, इस पॉलिसी को बिल्कुल इंडोसेंट्रिक बताया गया. और अर्लियर पॉलिसी में क्या था कि ये सारे पॉलिसीज को थोड़ा वेस्टर्न एजुकेशन सिस्टम किस प्रकार से चल रहा था, इन वेस्टर्न एजुकेशन सिस्टम का इमिटेशन करके बनाया गया था. बट दिस पॉलिसी देयर इज नो सच टाइप ऑफ डाउट ऑफ इमिटेशन, इट इज प्योरली बेस्ड ऑन द इंडियन सिस्टम. इसीलिए भारत पर ज़्यादा ध्यान दिया गया है कि ये पूरा पॉलिसी में ये किसी लिए बोला है. अभी प्राइम मिनिस्टर के सारे कॉन्क्लेव हुआ था, दैट वॉज कंडक्टेड बाई द UGC एट द टाइम. तो प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने कहा था कि अब इस पॉलिसी के द्वारा आने वाले समय में भारत फलेगा, भारत को बहुत बड़ा बेनिफिट होगा, ये ध्यान में देखते हुए ही इस पॉलिसी को बनाया गया है. कि इसलिए कस्तूरी रंगन को उसने थैंक यू दे रहा था. तो इसलिए हम समझते हैं कि एक इंडोसेंट्रिक है कि भारतीय कल्चर, भारतीय संप्रभुता, भारत की अस्मिता, जैसे भारत एक समय में विश्वगुरु था. तो अभी ऑक्सफोर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी का मान लें, दैट वाज एस्टैब्लिश इन 17वीं सदी में वो एस्टैब्लिश हुआ था, लेकिन इस भारत में बिफोर ख्रिस्त 2500 ईयर्स हमारे देश में बहुत सारी यूनिवर्सिटी बनी थी. नालंदा विश्वविद्यालय, तक्षशिला विश्वविद्यालय, उज्जैन विश्वविद्यालय, विक्रमशिला विश्वविद्यालय, इन सब विश्वविद्यालय में देश विदेश के तमाम विद्यार्थी आगे पढ़ते थे। एज वी नो दैट नालंदा विश्वविद्यालय हैविंग 10,000 स्टूडेंट्स कैपेसिटी टाइम देर इज अ बिग हॉस्टल लॉट ऑफ हॉस्टल्स ऑफ फॉरेन फॉर इवन फॉरेन कंट्रीज स्टूडेंट कैन स्टे देयर। और इसके बाद उनका जो ग्रंथालय था, इतना बड़ा ग्रंथालय था द लाइब्रेरी, जिसको जैसे वो संगीज खान ने जब उस पर हमला किया था तो जब जला दिया था लाइब्रेरी, 6 महीने तक जलता रहा था। इसीलिए सो इन सब चीज़ों को भारत में विज्ञान का चर्चा हुआ था, हमने एस्ट्रोनॉमी साइंस पर हुआ था, खगोल हुआ था, योगा पर हुआ था, दर्शन पर हुआ था, चिकित्सा शास्त्र पर हुआ था, चरक संहिता, जीवक संहिता, तो सुश्रुत संहिता, इन सब सारे संहिताएं भारत में थी। तो इवन हमारे विमान शास्त्र थी, हमारे यहाँ पर 36 विमानों की बात कही थी, आज तक कितने भी विमान निकाले 16 इंजिन तक ही निकाल पाए, 16 विमान तक विमान की इंजिन की बात बता रहा हूँ मैं, तो 36 प्रकार के इंजन। तो इन सब पर रिसर्च हो, आने वाले समय में इन पे रिसर्च हो, हमारे पास हथियार था, हमारे जो नाविक विज्ञान है, नेवी नेविगेशनल साइंस, जो नेवी साइंस, तो वो भी बहुत बड़ा था कि भारत के सेठ महाराज सेठ लोग बाजार करने जा रहे थे अरबियन क्रांति, इसीलिए पूरे पूरे विश्व का नामकरण भारत ने किया था, सूरीनाम से लेकर श्याम देश से लेकर जावा देश, श्याम देश, आपका पाताल देश जो अमेरिका है, पाताल देश को अमेरिका कहा जाता है, यानी अरबियन कंट्रीज, इन सब में क्या है, एक समय था जो भारत का ही बुलबाला था, एक सांस्कृतिक राष्ट्रवाद पूरे पूरे विश्व में एक सांस्कृतिक है, वसुधैव कुटुंबकम ऐसा चलता था। सो दिस पॉलिसी इज बेस्ड ऑन इंडोसेंट्रिक, सो इसमें आने वाले समय में कोई भी रिसर्च होगा, कोई भी वी आर गोइंग टू डिजाइनिंग अवर सिलेबस, तो अवर सिलेबस शुड बी ऑन द लोकल इश्यूज पर हो सकता है, हमारे हमारे हर आपके पास जो भी कुछ भी है उस पर हमारा रिसर्च करना बहुत जरूरी है। तो ये इंडोसेंट्रिक कहा जाता है, और इसमें बच्चे को किसी भी सब्जेक्ट लेने का चॉइस है, फिर एक मातृभाषा में ज्ञान होने का। अब मान लीजिए जो एजुकेशन पैटर्न मैंने बताया कि अभी 5+, एक बच्चे पहले था 6 महीने में एक विद्यार्थी एजुकेशन में जाता था स्कूल में, तो आफ्टर 6 इयर्स स्कूल में जाता था, तो वो 6 साल में आजकल के बच्चे बूढ़ा हो जाता है। आप देखिए आपके घर में 2 साल का बच्चा है या बच्ची है, तो दे वांट टू participate in every in your decisions, माने कोई फैमिली का we are going to take some decision, so that this 2 years students या 2 years children can have the nature to interfere your discussion, माने घर का कलर हम ऐसा करेंगे, बट बच्चे बोलेंगे नहीं हमारा घर का कलर ऐसा होना चाहिए पापा या मम्मी हम ऐसा, तो ultimately the decision योर चाइल्ड, तो आपका जो डिसीजन हम इसके, इसीलिए बताइए अभी 6 साल बड़ा हो गया, अभी 3 साल में स्कूलिंग उनका होना चाहिए, तो इसीलिए 3 साल में स्कूल में एंट्री होगा, तो 3 साल तक मान लो कोई स्लम एरिया का बच्चा है, तो वो स्लम एरिया में 6 साल तक वो बिल्कुल बिगड़ जाता है, बच्चे का कैरेक्टर बिल्कुल बिगड़ जाता है, उसका हैबिट, उसका नेचर, इसीलिए 3 साल में हमारे चाइल्ड को हम स्कूल लाना चाहिए, और 3 साल के बाद हमें क्या करना चाहिए, तो उनको बाकी एक मान लीजिए कोई आपका अच्छे घराने के बच्चा है और किसी एक बिल्कुल स्लम एरिया का बच्चा है, गरीब का बच्चा है, लेबर का बच्चा है, दिन हजीरा कर, तो उनका बच्चा और एक अमीर का बच्चा एक सारे स्कूल पढ़ेंगे आफ्टर 3 इयर्स, सो दे विल ग्रो, उनका न्यूट्रिशन का ध्यान दिया गया है इसमें, उनको मिड डे मील दिया जाएगा या उनको ब्रेकफास्ट से लेकर पूरा मिड डे मील तक देने की व्यवस्था इस पॉलिसी के अंडर में है, ताकि उनको समान रूप से पौष्टिक आहार मिले और इससे स्कूल में पौष्टिक आहार मिले और उनको केवल मातृभाषा का ज्ञान मिले और कुछ खेल कूद, उनको कोई किताब लेके नहीं जाने का है। आजकल जैसे हम स्कूल भेजते तो बड़ा बड़ा बैग झोला में भर के हमें स्कूल भेजना पड़ता है बच्चे को, सो दिस इज द मेन थिंग, सो दिस पॉलिसी का ये है कि मातृभाषा और एक मल्टीलिंगुअल नॉलेज का डेवलपमेंट होगा। मान लीजिए हम शुरू में अभी फिर जो 5+ में जो है 3 और 3 और 2 2 2 इयर्स क्या रहेगा 2 इयर्स, दो साल का उनका प्री प्राइमरी प्रीपेटे रहेगा, जो आंगनबाड़ी टाइप के स्कूल्स होंगे, आंगनबाड़ी को और थोड़ा अच्छा बनाया जाएगा, उनके जो टीचर्स है दे हैव टू बी गो थ्रू सम रिगोरियस ट्रेनिंग, ऑनलाइन ट्रेनिंग, सो ताकि हाउ कैन वी केयरिंग अवर चाइल्ड। तो इसलिए इसमें क्या है, और एक इसमें एक प्रोजेक्ट इस पर का है जिसको कहा था कि एक समान पर सभी बच्चे को सुविधा मिले, इसलिए यू आर जी करके है कि अंडर रिप्रेजेंटेटिव ग्रुप, अंडर रिप्रेजेंटेटिव ग्रुप को इससे देखेगा कि इसीलिए इस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ऑनली द नॉट ए सिंगल केयरिंग है, जैसे कहा जाता है शिक्षा, शिक्षा विभाग ही इसको नहीं देखेगा, शिक्षा विभाग इसको इंप्लीमेंट करेगा, लेकिन अभी 5-6 डिपार्टमेंट्स एक संहत जिसको कहा जाता है कि इंटीग्रेटेड प्रोग्रामिंग है, जिसमें एक बाल और बाल शिक्षा बाल विभाग रहेगा और इसमें स्वास्थ्य और महिला कल्याण विभाग रहेगा, सोशल जस्टिस विभाग है, जो सोशल जस्टिस जो सामाजिक न्याय विभाग है भारत सरकार का वो भी काम करेगा, ट्राइबल अफेयर्स है ट्राइबल बच्चे को पढ़ाई के लिए, ट्राइबल स्टूडेंट्स को टारगेट ट्राइबल, ताकि इनको समान रूप से सब एक बच्चे को देखभाल करने के लिए इतने सारे डिपार्टमेंट्स ज्वाइंट एफोर्ट में काम करेंगे आने वाले समय में अंडर दिस न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी। सो ये एक बहुत बड़ी आपकी बड़ी उपलब्धि होगी। तो इसीलिए एक देखिए छोटा बच्चा है इज आफ्टर 6 क्लास पढ़ रही है और क्लास 6 के बाद 7-8 ये कंप्यूटर कोडिंग का व्यवस्था हो जाएगा। नॉर्मली वी आर यूज टू से दैट चाइनीज बच्चे जापानीज बच्चे एकदम बच्चे में ही वो लोग कई कंप्यूटर के एप्लीकेशन बना लेते हैं, एप्स बना लेते हैं, सो व्हाई नॉट द इंडियन चाइल्ड। तो आई थिंक दैट इंडियन चाइल्ड्स आर बेटर, दे आर मोर ब्रिलियंट देन अदर कंट्रीज, बिकॉज therefore before आज से 20-30 साल पहले एक नया शब्द चला था, दैट इज ब्रेन ड्रेन, यानी इंडियंस ब्रेन्स आर वेरी एक्टिव एंड वेरी ब्रिलियंट ब्रेन हैविंग टैलेंट। तो भारत अमेरिका में सब हर एक क्षेत्र में आप जाइए भारतीय है, आज पेंटागन में हैविंग 35 आर्मी ऑफिसर्स बिलोंगिंग टू इंडियन, आज नासा में 55% साइंटिस्ट बिलोंगिंग टू इंडियन। तो हमारे ये गौरव का विषय है कि वी हैव द टैलेंट, और अगर हम बच्चे को इस प्रकार का वी विल ऑर्गेनाइज सच दिस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी गिविंग सच ए प्लेटफॉर्म, एक प्लेटफॉर्म हो गया कि स्टूडेंट कैन अभी ऐप बना सकते हैं। सो कंप्यूटर कोडिंग की व्यवस्था अभी क्लास 6-7-8 में भी रहेगा, सो इवन 8 के बच्चे को इंटर्नशिप देने की व्यवस्था है, हमारे जो हम इंजीनियरिंग के बच्चे भी इंटर्नशिप भेजते हैं, सो हमारे अभी एक स्कूल बच्चे भी इंटर्नशिप कर सकते हैं किसी नियर बाय, मान लीजिए मैं इलेक्ट्रिशियन, घर में आप देखिए आपका बच्चा अगर मान लीजिए 10-12 साल का है, वो जाके आपका तुरंत जाके कोई भी चीज़ घर में खराब होता है वो जाके अपना स्क्रू ड्राइवर लेके काम शुरू कर देता है, आप बोलने की जरूरत नहीं, वो जाके इलेक्ट्रिक खराब हो रहा है पंखा वो स्विच खोल के कर देगा, देखिए इसके उसका वो एक नॉलेज देता है, मोबाइल ठीक कर देगा आपका बच्चा, so they have the power, अभी साइंटिस्ट ने देखा है, सोशल साइंटिस्ट ने, कि इन आजकल के बच्चे में वो दिमाग है, so we need the computer coding system, this education policy providing computer coding system in school level, so ये एक बार। तो इसमें से और एक बात है कि इस पॉलिसी का एक बहुत बेहतरीन व्यवस्था यह है कि this policy giving GDP rate, enhancing the GDP rate up to 6%. So, देखिए अभी पहले हमारा 2% 2% था, तो हमारा all the stakeholder from various organizations are always demanding that our GDP should be increased in education sector. ये demand सरकार ने अभी तो बहुत साल से ऐसा demand तो नहीं आ रहा था, लेकिन सरकार ने ये सोची है और सरकार ने इसीलिए अंडर दिस पॉलिसी द जी डी पी रेट एनहेंस अप टू 6%, जिससे आने वाले समय में हमारे शिक्षा व्यवस्था में पैसे की कोई कमी नहीं रहेगी, आने वाले समय में एक पूरा युद्ध स्तर पर काम शुरू होगा, सो फ्रॉम 2021 इट विल बी कम इन फोर्स, जो इम्प्लीमेंटेशन किया जाएगा और 2030 तक इसको टारगेटेड है, विद इन दिस पीरियड दिस पॉलिसी विल फुलफिल all the aspect, लेकिन हम जैसे एकेडमिशियंस, हम जैसे यूनिवर्सिटी के कॉलेज के टीचर्स को हमें काम करना पड़ेगा। हमें आने वाले समय, हम देश को ध्यान में रखते हुए, हमारे देश के बच्चे के भविष्य को देखते हुए, हमें अगर ठीक से काम करें आने वाले समय बहुत इम्प्लीमेंटेशन हो जाएगा। तो इसीलिए बहुत सवाल भी उठ रहा है कि दिस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी इंडिकेटिंग रिगार्डिंग द प्राइवेट पार्टिसिपेशन। तो प्राइवेट पार्टिसिपेशन बहुत बढ़िया चीज है। अब हम इसको, दिस इज नॉट प्राइवेटाइज, प्राइवेटाइजेशन के बारे में नहीं कर, दिस इज कॉल्ड दैट प्राइवेट पार्टिसिपेशन। अभी हमारा शिक्षा मंत्रालय में भारत सरकार के पास जो रिकॉर्ड है, तो रिकॉर्ड के अनुसार हमारे देश के वी आर हैविंग नाउ 26 करोड़ स्टूडेंट्स। तो आउट ऑफ 26 करोड़ स्टूडेंट्स, 48% स्टूडेंट्स आर रीडिंग इन प्राइवेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस। आप स्कूल से एक केजी से लेकर नर्सरी से लेकर आपका यूनिवर्सिटी लेवल तक अगर 48% बच्चे, हमारी ये मानसिकता है, हम अपने बच्चे को गवर्नमेंट स्कूल में नहीं भेजते हैं, तो हम भेजते हैं तुरंत कहाँ, हम प्राइवेट, चाहे वो टूटी फूटी भी हो, लेकिन वो प्राइवेट इस हमारे दिमाग में खाका में बैठ गया। बट इस सिस्टम को, गवर्नमेंट सिस्टम को, नाउ दिस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ट्राइंग टू, दिस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ट्राइंग टू एस्टाब्लिश दिस दैट द गवर्नमेंट इंस्टीट्यूशन टू बी डेवलप ग्रो, आने वाले समय धीरे धीरे में खत्म हो जाएगा प्राइवेट। जब सरकार, जैसे अमेरिका में तो प्राइवेट में, प्राइवेट नहीं, सब गवर्नमेंट इंस्टीट्यूशन है। आपके बच्चे को 7 बजे घर से लेके जाएगा, शाम को 4 बजे घर में वापस कर देगा, आप खाली जैसे तैसे ब्रशिंग, टूथ ब्रशिंग करके भेज दो। तो वो सिस्टम इम्प्लीमेंट इन आवर कंट्री ऑल्सो आने वाले समय में। तो इससे क्या हो जाएगा, अभी प्राइवेट पार्टिसिपेशन है, लेकिन इसमें एक चीज है कि दिस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ये होलिस्टिक अप्रोच, होलिस्टिक एजुकेशन पॉलिसी, इसीलिए कि इसमें बहुत सारे वस्तुओं का ध्यान दिया गया है। तो इसीलिए क्या है कि आने वाले समय में प्राइवेट तो रहेगा, लेकिन कमर्शियलाइजेशन नहीं रहेगा, कोई कैपिटेशन फीस नहीं रहेगा, कोई डोनेशन नहीं रहेगा, नहीं भी ले सकता है, नहीं ले सकता है। तो ये इवन द गवर्नमेंट विल फिक्स द फीस, फी रेट, एडमिशन रेट ऑल ओवर द कंट्री। सो एजुकेशन के रेगुलेटरी बॉडी बन रहा है, ये सब देखने वाले, हर स्टेट कमीशन बनेगी और आने वाले समय में पूरा देखभाल करेगा। इसीलिए मैंने कहा कि इस पॉलिसी का मेन एक चीज है कि इसमें एक, इस पॉलिसी में एक एकेडमिक बैंक क्रेडिट सिस्टम जो है, कि एक बच्चे को आप एकेडमिक बैंक क्रेडिट से आपका खाते में आपका ग्रेडिंग रहेगा, आपका क्रेडिट रहेगा, जिसके अनुसार आपको आने वाले समय में आपको रिजल्ट दिया जाएगा, प्रोग्रेस कर दिया जाएगा। और ये आपको जो प्रोग्रेस कर दिया जाएगा, ये कैसे होगा, 360 डिग्री असेसमेंट रिपोर्ट है। एक बच्चे को 360 डिग्री असेसमेंट करेंगे, एकदम ऐसा नहीं कि उसको छोड़ देगा, 360 डिग्री असेसमेंट की व्यवस्था अंडर दिस पॉलिसी है, 360 डिग्री। इसीलिए, और इसमें और एक चीज है कि ऑटोनोमी टू द कॉलेजेस, आपका जैसे जो कॉलेज है, मान लीजिए नेताजी सुभाष कॉलेज है, महाविद्यालय, इस कॉलेज को क्या है, ऑटोनोमी मिल जाएगा, सभी कॉलेज को ऑटोनोमी मिल जाएगा। तो इसीलिए, और हमारा इस पॉलिसी में जो टारगेट है, अप टू 2030 प्राइमरी एजुकेशन में 100% टारगेट रखा है कि 100% GER, जो ग्रॉस एनरोलमेंट रेशियो, ये हमारे अभी भारत में वी आर हैविंग ओनली 26% GER। और इसलिए अभी आने वाले आपको 2030 तक क्या हो जाएगा, हमारा स्पेशली जो स्कूल एजुकेशन में 100% का टारगेट रखा है और हायर एजुकेशन में 50% का टारगेट रखा है। तो अगर 30 साल तक हम इस टारगेट को, जीआर को अचीव करेंगे, दैट विल बी द ग्रेट अचीवमेंट फॉर द इंडिया, रिपब्लिक ऑफ इंडिया। तो ये बहुत जरूरी है, इसीलिए मैंने बताया कि इसमें एक और हायर एजुकेशन में भी इसकी बहुत सारी सुविधा है। लेकिन अभी आने वाले इस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में क्या होगा, थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ एजुकेशन हो जाएगा। एक टाइप से रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूशंस, और दूसरा होगा टीचिंग इंस्टीट्यूशन, और तीसरा होगा ऑटोनोमस इंस्टीट्यूशंस। अभी यूनिवर्सिटी को कैटेगराइज किया गया है, अभी दो कैटेगराइज हो गया यूनिवर्सिटी, एक तो रिसर्च का ही एक्टिविटी करा है, लाइक इन अमेरिका आप देखिए सारे यूनिवर्सिटीज का रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूशन, उसमें केवल रिसर्च होता है। इसीलिए हमारा अभी कुछ रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूशन भारत में बनाएगा जिसमें रिसर्च होगा, अभी कुछ डिपार्टमेंटल रिसर्च बंद हो जाएगा। अभी हमारा यूनिवर्सिटी कैन कोई भी चीज बनाएगा उसका पेटेंट कर सकेगा, उसको वो उसको आप कंपनी वो प्रोडक्ट मार्केटिंग वो बेच सकता है उसको प्रोडक्ट। इसीलिए अभी जो एक रिसर्च नेशनल रिसर्च फाउंडेशन बनने की है, एक अभी एक नेशनल रिसर्च फाउंडेशन गोइंग टू एस्टेब्लिश नेशनल रिसर्च फाउंडेशन, दैट फाउंडेशन विल गिविंग फाइनेंशियल असिस्टेंट टू द इंस्टीट्यूशन, सच टाइप ऑफ रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूशन। तो इसीलिए यूनिवर्सिटी का कैटेगराइज होगा, और दूसरा यूनिवर्सिटी होगा एक केवल टीचिंग यूनिवर्सिटी रहेगा, उसमें रिसर्च नहीं रहेगा, केवल टीचिंग यूनिवर्सिटी रहेगा। और तीसरा है कि एक ऑटोनोमस इंस्टीट्यूशन, स्पेशली ये ऑटोनोमस इंस्टीट्यूट फॉर द कॉलेजेस, हमारे जैसे जो डिग्री कॉलेजेस है पीजी कॉलेज, इन कॉलेजेस को एक ऑटोनोमस स्टेटस उनको दिया जाएगा। इसीलिए ये होगा, जैसे अभी हमारा एक अम्ब्रेला संगठन होगा, कहते क्या है हायर एजुकेशन काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया, ये गठन होने जा रहा है। और इसके लिए जब काउंसिल ये कमीशन है, तो कमीशन के लिए अभी आने वाले संसद में पार्लियामेंट सेशन में एक बिल आएगा, अभी बिल ड्राफ्ट हो गया है, सरकार ने बनाई है, और इस बिल के तहत अभी उसका एस्टेब्लिशमेंट करेगा कमीशन का। ये तो पॉलिसी है, पॉलिसी कैन अनाउंस बाय द कैबिनेट डिसीजन, सो बट अभी कमीशन के लिए क्या है, इसको पार्लियामेंट में पास होना पड़ेगा। तो अभी आने वाले समय में कमीशन होगा, और इसमें इस चार टाइप का इंस्टीट्यूशन रहेगा एक अम्ब्रेला के नीचे, वो है जैसे अभी सर ने भी बताया था कि नेशनल रिसर्च सॉरी नेशनल एजुकेशन रेगुलेटरी काउंसिल, जिसमें केवल जो पॉलिसी रिगार्डेड पॉलिसी कैसे यूनिवर्सिटी को चलना है, किस प्रकार से परमिशन देना है, जो अभी यूजीसी करती हैं जो वैसा वो करेगा वो करेगी। और तीसरा है कि एक नेशनल एक हायर एजुकेशन ग्रैंड काउंसिल, जो अभी ग्रांटिंग को पॉलिसी से अलग कर दिया है, जो किस प्रकार से हम ग्रैंड करेंगे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलपमेंट के लिए, वो ग्रैंड काउंसिल उसका ग्रैंड करेगा। और असेसमेंट के लिए नेक रहेगा, नेशनल असेसमेंट एंड एक्रेडिटेशन काउंसिल रहेगी। और इसी हिसाब से जो एक नया इस एजुकेशन स्कूल एजुकेशन के लिए आप सेकेंडरी लेवल एक परख जैसे नैक है, ऐसे परख करके एक नया एक एजेंसी बनाया है, जो एजेंसी क्या करेगी जो स्कूल एजुकेशन को नेक्स्ट जैसा उसके ग्रेडिंग करेगा, उसको एक्रेडिटेशन करेगा, इसका विजिट करेगा, इसीलिए वो भी सारे ऑनलाइन सिस्टम से होगा। और तीसरा चौथा है कि एक जनरल एजुकेशन काउंसिल, अभी हमारे बहुत सारे काउंसिल्स है, ICHR है, ICPR है, ICSSR है, फिर आपका मेडिकल काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया है, फिर फार्मास्यूटिकल काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया है, ऑल काउंसिल विल कंसिस्टेड इन ए सिंगल काउंसिल दैट इज जनरल एजुकेशन काउंसिल, उसके अंदर में अलग अलग काउंसिल्स का रहेगा देखभाल करने वाला। तो ये फोर काउंसिल्स रहेगी और नेशनल रिसर्च काउंसिल रहेगा। तो इस प्रकार से हम देखें तो ये है। और इसमें इस पॉलिसी में एक बात मैं बताना चाहूँगा, जो कि मान लीजिए अभी जो डिग्री एजुकेशन आपको जैसे प्लस टू खत्म, अभी जैसे आपका बच्चा एट्थ के बाद नाइन आएगा, नाइन टेन इलेवन ट्वेल्व, ये चार जो पैटर्न है ये फोर ईयर्स में रहेगा। ये फोर ईयर्स में स्टूडेंट को कोई इसमें सेमिस्टर सिस्टम में एग्जाम देना पड़ेगा, और इसमें बोर्ड एग्जाम टेन में बोर्ड एग्जाम रहेगा और या तो ट्वेल्व में बोर्ड एग्जाम रहेगी। तो इसमें क्या है, कोई ऐसा स्ट्रीम को फिनिश कर लिया, स्ट्रीम नहीं रहेगा, अभी मल्टी डिसिप्लिन है, कोई भी सब्जेक्ट ले सके, केमिस्ट्री फिजिक्स लेने वाला बच्चा भी हिस्ट्री पढ़ सकता है या एनवायरमेंटल साइंस पढ़ सकता है या कोई एग्रीकल्चर का सब्जेक्ट भी पढ़ सकता है, क्योंकि एक स्टूडेंट्स को इंटरेस्ट के हिसाब से वो स्वतंत्र है। मैंने कहा कि स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली है, तो स्टूडेंट कैन चूज देयर सब्जेक्ट एज दे डिजायर। तो इस प्रकार ये नहीं कि मैंने एक साल पढ़ के मैंने एग्रीकल्चर छोड़ दिया और अगला साल मैं चला गया, लेकिन वो एकेडमिक क्रेडिट जो बैंक सिस्टम है उससे हमारे एक साल का क्रेडिट जमा रहेगा, क्रेडिट देखा जाएगा और क्रेडिट के हिसाब से उनको रिजल्ट दिया जाएगा। तो बाद में जब वो स्कूलिंग में स्कूल जाएगा, हमारा जो सॉरी कॉलेज जाएगा, हायर एजुकेशन में हमारा पैटर्न रहेगा, इसमें क्या है मल्टी एंट्री एंड मल्टी एग्जिट की सिस्टम है, जिसमें हमारा जैसे तीन साल का प्रोग्राम भी रहेगा बीए का, माने ग्रेजुएशन का चार साल का भी रहेगा। और मान लीजिए अभी जो ड्रॉपिंग आउट सिस्टम को, ड्रॉपिंग आउट स्टूडेंट को खत्म करने के लिए हमने क्या इसमें इस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में क्या दी गई है, ताकि इसमें कोई बच्चे एक साल पढ़ के निकल गया, मान लीजिए उनको एक साल में एक सर्टिफिकेट कोर्स एक सर्टिफिकेट करेगा, वो कॉलेज खुद सर्टिफाई कर सकेगा, एक सर्टिफिकेट इशू कर सकता है, दो साल करके जाएगा तो उनको एडवांस डिप्लोमा इशू कर सकता है, तीन साल करेगा डिग्री का सर्टिफिकेट है, चार साल करेगा, चार साल के प्रोग्राम में डिग्री विथ रिसर्च सर्टिफिकेट दिया जाएगा, वो बस फिर पीजी पढ़ने की जरूरत नहीं है रिसर्च के लिए, क्योंकि उसको जो आफ्टर कंप्लीशन ऑफ थ्री इयर्स डिग्री एक साल का जो रहेगा उसमें रिसर्च एथिक्स सिखा जाएगा। दो वो स्टूडेंट है, दो स्टूडेंट हु आर इंटरेस्टेड इन रिसर्च एक्टिविटी, ऐसे बच्चे एक साल का अलग से फोर इयर्स प्रोग्राम में जा सकते हैं। एक साल का जो रिसर्च एथिक्स रहेगा जिससे वो आने वाले समय डायरेक्ट वो रिसर्च एक्टिविटी में जा सकता है, किसी भी इंस्टीट्यूशन में जाके जो रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूशन है वहां जाके डायरेक्ट रिसर्च कर सकता है, क्योंकि उतना फिर बुरा हो जाएगा, हमें बहुत दिन पीजी करना है फिर रिसर्च देना, ऐसे नहीं। उसके लिए जो इंस्टीट्यूशनल टेस्ट होगा, एक की जवान होते समय ही वो बहुत कुछ इस देश के लिए दे सकेगा, तेज दिमाग लगाएगा रिसर्च एंड इनोवेशन में, और आने वाले समय में हमारे देश का बहुत भलाई होगा इस एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में। और जो एक जो मान लीजिए अभी शिक्षक बनेगा, शिक्षक जो बनेगा वो अभी पहले से तय करेगा मुझे शिक्षक बनना है, इसीलिए वो जाएगा FIP प्रोग्राम में जाएगा चार साल का, और वहां से जाके वो डायरेक्ट टीचिंग में जा सकता है, उसको फिर मास्टर डिग्री PG वो जरूरी नहीं है, अगर वो रिसर्च करेगा तो जाके वो प्रोफेसर भी बन सकता है, ऐसी दिक्कत नहीं है। तो इस प्रकार का एक रिलैक्सेशन है, स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली पॉलिसी है, तो मुझे लगता है कि ये आने वाले समय में इस पॉलिसी के तहत हमारा बहुत सारे लाभ हो जाएगा। और असेसमेंट, और इसमें एक चीज है कि टीचर्स ट्रेनिंग, टीचर्स ट्रेनिंग को बहुत देखा गया है कि टीचर्स ट्रेनिंग को बहुत ज्यादा ध्यान दिया गया है, और इसको अलग अलग क्लस्टर लेवल से लेकर आपको यूनिवर्सिटी लेवल सब हर पर्याय में कि ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन FDP प्रोग्राम शुरू करेगा, और जिससे क्या होगा आने वाले समय, इसीलिए एक अभी हमारा एक प्रोग्राम नया प्रोग्राम है, उस प्रोग्राम के तहत अभी हमने शुरू कर दिया UGC ने, उसी को न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में लगाया गया है टीचर्स का जो इंडिकेशन प्रोग्राम, फैकल्टी इंडिकेशन प्रोग्राम FIP बोलते हैं, और एक SIP भी, स्टूडेंट इंडक्शन प्रोग्राम भी है। तो ये फैकल्टी इंडक्शन प्रोग्राम के तहत अभी बहुत ट्रेनिंग दिया जाएगा सर, ये सब ऑनलाइन भी चलेगा और इंस्टीट्यूशनल भी चलेगा, ऑफलाइन भी चलेगा, तो इससे टीचर्स का ट्रेनिंग। और असेसमेंट के बारे में बताया कि एक 360 डिग्री असेसमेंट होगा, उसको रिपोर्ट कार्ड मिलेगा, और जिससे क्या है असेसमेंट की बड़ी बहुत सुविधा है, इवोल्यूशन पार्ट भी है, और हमें एकदम जाके अभी डिस्क्रिप्टिव एग्जामिनेशन देने का नहीं है, मैंने बताया कि डे टू डे एक्टिविटी पर असेसमेंट हो जाएगा, इसीलिए इससे एक बच्चे को पूरा आजादी है पढ़ने की आजादी। मान लीजिए एक मल्टी एग्जिट में क्या है, एक बच्चा 2 साल पढ़ने के बाद, मान लो वो खिलाड़ी है, 1 साल किसी ट्रेनिंग में गया, ओलंपिक ट्रेनिंग में गया, या नेशनल स्पोर्ट्स बोर्ड में जाके वो साई में गया, स्पोर्ट्स अथॉरिटी में इंडिया में ट्रेनिंग लिया 1 साल का, मान लो वो 1 साल गैप हो गया उनका, इससे गैप नहीं होगा, वहाँ का जो एक्टिविटी है वो उनको रिपोर्ट कार्ड में वो एंट्री हो जाएगा, आने के बाद वो फिर यहाँ जाए डिग्री 3 इयर्स डिग्री मिल जाएगा, कोई दिक्कत नहीं है कि वो स्पोर्ट्स उनका सब्जेक्ट हो गया है, इसी को बोलते हैं कि मल्टी डिसिप्लिन है। 2 साल मैंने 2 सब्जेक्ट हिस्ट्री इकोनॉमिक्स पढ़ा, और मुझे 1 साल में खेल में एक्टिविटी में रहा, लेकिन मुझे ग्रेजुएशन मिल गया, ये है या स्टूडेंट फ्रेंडली है, इतना बढ़िया पॉलिसी इसमें बनाया गया है। मुझे लगता है
कि
समय हो चला है, 7:30 तक मेरा टाइम है, और इट इज नाउ जस्ट फिनिश माय टाइम, आई थिंक दैट आई ट्राई टू शेयर माय सम व्यूज, दैट इज वेरी रैपिड रिव्यूज ऑन माय NEP, सो आई एम शेयरिंग विद यू, होप दैट यू हर्ड इट एंड आपको अच्छा लगा होगा, धन्यवाद। मुझे इस यहाँ मुझे जो मौका दिया गया है उसके लिए मैं डॉक्टर सुरजीत सेन सर को मैं विशेष रूप से धन्यवाद करना चाहता हूँ, फिर अपना पेट्रियट देव वर्मा जी हैं डॉक्टर, उनको भी मैं धन्यवाद करता हूँ, धन्यवाद,
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर, वी हैव बीन रियली एनरिच्ड विद योर व्यूज एंड आइडियाज, बहुत बहुत अच्छा लगा ये लेक्चर आपका, बिकॉज इट हैज बीन फ्रेंडली वन, इट हैज बीन वेरी होमली वन, सो डू टेक केयर, एंड वी आर राइट नाउ प्रोसीडिंग टू आवर नेक्स्ट स्पीकर who is working as a principal in one of the finest schools in Agartala, the Mrs. Shapna Shom. She is working right now as a principal at Bhavan Tripura Vidya Mandir. She has been working as a principal for the last more than 5 years there, and with quality and with enormous efficiency. So over to you, Mrs. Shom, who will be enlightening us on the school education, how school education is going to be impacted by the new education policy. Sorry, madam, you can take another 5 minutes because we have the earlier speaker, he had you know gone a bit too far. So you can take more than 5 minutes of that. So over to you, Mrs. Shapna Shom, who is working as a principal at Bhavan Sabha. And very good evening to you, madam. And over to you right now for your presentation.
Thank you so much. Very good evening to our Honorable Minister, sir, all learned scholars and viewers. I'm really honored to be a part of this enriched webinar, Understanding NEP 2020, organized by the Department of English Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya. Thank you so much to the organizing committee for providing me with this opportunity, especially to my guru, Dr. Rita Das Nayak. She has always been an inspiration to me. Till now, we have heard from our minister, sir, from Dr. Kiran Hazarika, sir, and they have given us a quite broader knowledge about the National Education Policy 2020. And if you will go on reading the policy from top to bottom, you will go on reading it, and the line by line, you can enrich yourself, and you will be started loving it, that if all these things will be implemented in a very nice way by our stakeholders, then really there will be a drastic change in the system of education. So anyway, today I will be mainly focusing on the school education, and hope I'll be able to do justice to the organizing committee, those who have kept faith on me. So I have been told not to use that extra 5 minutes. So I'll try that. I will be maintaining the time, and we'll be finishing up and trying to give just an outline about the policy, particularly focusing on the school education. National Education Policy 2020. National Education Policy 2020 is really a great gift in the field of education for the present and future generation of the country in this pandemic situation. This policy is showing us that there may be ups and downs, but whatever may be the situation, it is our moral responsibility to fight with the present situation and plan for a better future. Now, let me present by sharing my screen. I'll try to give a gist picture of the policy, and I hope that it will try to. Just let me share my screen, and I hope that the viewers will really be I'll be able to make them understand that what are the main basic concept of this policy. As it has been well said by my previous speaker, that it is student friendly, it is more student friendly, and it's a fact that it is more student friendly. Maximum emphasis was been given to the students. Maximum emphasis was been given to the students. They were the prime focus. So our first education policy was started in the year 1968. Usually education policies consist of the principles and government policies in the education sphere, as well as the collections of laws and rules that govern the operation of the education system. So this education policy 2020 is the first education policy of the 21st century that replaces 34 years old national policy on education 1986, with tremendous changes in every level of education, starting from the grassroots, catering the need of the present situation. So I work in a school, so we deal with the children at their growing stage. So here, we're at the growing stage, that means we start catering them from the level zero level towards the teenage. So let me start with the foundational pillars of this policy. The rich heritage of ancient and eternal Indian knowledge and thought have been a guiding light of this policy. The pursuit of knowledge, gyan, wisdom, pragya, and truth, satya, was always considered in Indian thoughts and philosophy as the highest human goals. That is why our education system was one of the most enriched education systems since time immemorial. Sir has also given so many examples of the well-known universities that used to exist in our country. So this, the aim of education in ancient India was not just the acquisition of knowledge as preparation for life in this world or life beyond schooling, but for the complete realization and liberation of the self. So the foundational pillars that has been kept in this policy was, you can see that access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability. So on this basic foundational pillar, the whole policy is standing, that the students should be able to access education, equal opportunity they can get, and not only that, they will be able to afford the system of education or whatever they want to do. And that the next pillar was affordability and accountability. That not only getting an education, it should be accountable, the teachers as well as from the learners and the learning, both. So I will be mainly focusing on the, as I said, the school education system. So some of the important highlights to start with, the first one is universal access at all level of school education. So here some important points were being emphasized by the policy. The policy emphasizes on ensuring universal access to school education at all levels, from preschool to the secondary, by facilitating students' multiple pathway to learning, involving both formal and non-formal modes, bringing the dropouts into the mainstream. This is really a wonder of this policy. Providing infrastructural support, as it has been said that the GDP amount of the contribution in the field of education will be nearly double from the next year. So this will be really a great help and to the educationists, so that the plans that they are making for our children for the implementation will be properly implemented. Providing infrastructure and well-trained social worker will also be associated with the school. See, peer tutoring, that is also a very new thing in this policy. This is the previous system. I hope that you can understand it, that till now we are following the system 10 plus 2. And before, play schools are still there, but it was not included in the formal education system. Now, till now, the system that we are following is 10 plus 2 system, that is 10 years of schooling from class 1 to 10 and then 2 years of 11 and 12. And where the children are having the option of choosing their subjects. Now you can understand that most of you are in this system only, that how much pressurized the children are once they could not do well in class 10 exam. Because see, I am dealing with the students every year, and what I find that how there is a social pressure, family pressure, parental pressure, because till now we could not come out with the concept of that our children, that either they will become doctor or they will become engineer. Once a child is passing class 10, that he must take science, or else we are making it a hierarchy, that science, the best students are taking it, then coming the commerce, and then coming the arts. So when you enter, I'm an arts student. So when I enter the class, I find that the gloomy faces are there in class 11 arts room when we go. So it really takes a long time for us to motivate the children that the stream or the classroom where you are sitting, it is not a punishment for you. From here, you can go to a far length. You can fulfill all your dreams. The only thing is that you need to do the hard work. Now, the present system is really a student-friendly system. So here you can see the system has become 5+3+3+4. That is the foundational stage. Then is the preparatory stage. Then is the middle. And then is the secondary. Now let us see what is there in the foundational stage. Here the age group is 3 to 5 years. So you see that over 85% of the child's communicative brain cumulative brain development occurs prior to the age of 6, which indicating the critical importance of appropriate care and stimulation for healthy brain development and growth. The National Curriculum and Pedagogical Framework for Early Child Care and Education for the children up to the age of 8 will be developed with the best practices in the national and international level. So the group is divided into two, split into two. Years of primary school, that is 5 complexes, and the class totally a separate cluster. It will be included in the complete system of the school education from Anganwadi to class 12. And the learning shall be based primarily on the play-based learning with a focus on developing cognitive, effective and psychomotor abilities and early literacy and numeracy. So to ensure that the best thing that the education policy has involved is ensure that all the students are ready for the school, and interim 3-month play school preparation module for class 1 will be developed by NCERT and SCERT both. That means before going to class 1, whether they are properly ready to go for it or not, that will be one of the main focus of this policy. Now let us go to the second stage, that is the preparatory schooling stage. So it will comprise 3 years of education building on the play, discovery, activity-based, pedagogical and curricular style of foundational stage, and will also begin to incorporate some light textbook. From here, they will be starting incorporating some of the light textbook as well as aspect of more formal but interactive classroom learning in order to lay a solid groundwork across the subject, including reading, writing, speaking, physical education, art, language, science, mathematics, etc. Now here, let me tell you that the age group will be 8 to 11 years in the grade of 3 to 5, and greater emphasis will be in the experiential learning. Experiential learning means learning by experience. So where the child will experience, I can give you some of the examples, like rather than teaching the young kids, showing them the elephant in the book. See, this is the elephant, and the child is trying to draw the elephant and developing an imagining that what will be the height of the elephant or how it will be looking like and what kind of teeth it is having, whether it is able to eat or not. So rather than going for all this, that the child can experience, we can take them to the zoo, and where they can have, I'm giving just a small example, because this experiential learning is not only for the small kids. Experiential learning has been included in all the stages, up to right from the foundational stage up to the secondary stage. So every stage we will be finding this experiential learning. Now next, let us come to the middle school. Here between 11 to 14 years, that is grade 6 to grade 8, middle school will comprise 3 years of education, building on the pedagogical and curricular style of the preparatory stage, but with the introduction of subject teachers for learning and discussing of the more abstract concept in each subject that the child will be ready of this stage across, that is science, maths, art, social science, and humanities. So again, experiential learning within each subject and exploration, the relation among different subjects will be encouraged and emphasized. Despite that, the most interesting feature is that introduction of more specialized subject. They will try to explore different subjects and new subjects will be introduced. So there will be more emphasis on integrating vocational education and with internship. Vocational education is still now existing in our education system, but this internship has been newly added. This is really very good, and I hope that we will be able to do it, for which we actually need lot of motivation, and the teachers will be needing lot of motivation, and further the teachers will need to motivate the parents to bring them in the existing system. So we all need to work, as it has been said by many of our speakers, that we all need to work. Not only we need to work, we have to give our total dedication and devotion. Then see the students, we will have to equip the students with new skill like carpentry, electric work, metal work, gardening, pottery, and coding will be introduced. I hope that the parents, our parents, learned parents will be taking it wholeheartedly, because you know, I am sharing my experience, a small one, that whenever we, start our annual sports practice, when we start practicing for our annual sports, so every year I receive near about 100 applications, parents mentioning that my child is having skin problem, my child is having allergy problem, my child is having this, my child is having, because you know that young couples and the modern parents, they are so much possessive with their children. So it will be really a mammoth task for us. Anyway, if all of us, we will work, with full dedication. So I'm sure that we will be able to, motivate the parents also for this, because we need to show them we have to show them that you don't see what happened, what your child is doing today. You have to see what your child will be doing after 20 years. So the target is that 50% of the students by 2025 have a comprehensive exposure towards the vocational education, and this 10 days bachelor's period of intern with local vocational experts. So this is really a very good one, that and I hope that the schools will be doing it with full dedication, that sending the children really to the nearby vocational experts. Like suppose I'm teaching the child carpentry, so I can take the child for 10 days, he will go there and really observe that how the carpentry works are going on in the workshops. Then let us come to the secondary stage. The secondary stage, this stage will comprise 4 years of multidisciplinary study, building on the subject-oriented pedagogical and curricular style of middle school, but with greater depth, greater critical thinking, greater attention of life aspirations, and greater flexibility. And students' choice of subject is really very good in this stage. So in particular, students would continue to have an option of exiting our grade 10 and re-entering in the next phase to pursue more. So you can see that 14 to 18 years of grades to of years students will be there from 9 to 12, which is further divided into 9, 10 and 11 and 12. It will be multidisciplinary, as it has been said, and student will have the option and they can exit in class 10 and re-enter to the next phase of class 11. So that can be done, and subject choice, like they can go for, as I have shown you the combination, that they can go for chemistry, BST and music. So they can focus on chemistry, and if they will go ahead with the business studies, so they can do business related to chemical industries, and music like as a lighter note or a minor subject, they can use it as for their hobby. So sometimes it happens that we see, this year only it happened in our school, that the girl want to study She has done very good result in class 12, but she wants to study dance. But there was a tremendous, family pressure that she should go for engineering, as her father was an engineer. But anyway, she could, you know. Now present generation is not like us. They are much more strong and determined. So she has, convinced her parents, and now she is going to study dance. So this will be really good for our children, because everybody cannot have the capacity to motivate their parents. So the next focus after this is on foundational literacy and numeracy. So it is considered as a prerequisite to learning. So national mission on foundational literacy and numeracy will be set up by MHRD. State will prepare implementation plans for attaining universal foundational literacy and numeracy. National book promotion policy will be formulated. So these are some of the things that will be taken care of. Then school curricula and pedagogy, holistic development of the learner will be looked after very seriously. Equipping students with 21st century skill, reduction in the curricular content to enhance essential learning and critical thinking. So this rote learning, which is still now going on, we find that the parents are, they always, when we take a class, so they wait that, madam, when you will be giving the notes, so that they will make their children to learn it, mug it up, so that they will get a good marks. So I hope that we will be able to motivate them and try to change the system and make the child write rather than going for the rote learning. So greater focus, as I have said, that experiential learning will be there in each and every stages, and flexibility in the choice of the subject that will be taken care of, and no rigid separation between arts, science, between curricular and extracurricular activities. So a child, wherever he is having an interest, he can go ahead with it. And the traditional system, I hope that I think that most of you will be agreeing with me that the traditional system, which is going on for such a long time, it will really take little bit time to change the mindset, not only of the students, parents, but also the faculties. So it is more important to motivate the faculties so that they can further carry it towards the parents and the children. So national curricular framework for the school education will be developed by NCRT. Lot of things need to be done. And multilingualism, that is the power of the language, we have been given emphasis in the education policy. Here, let me tell that we always believe, whenever we go for Bhavan's principal conference, so we are being taught that you tell your teachers that the basic concept should be taught in the mother language. Whether the teacher is teaching physics, chemistry, or geography, the basic concept in the class should be taught in the mother tongue of the child. So then he can easily understand it. So special emphasis in this policy was given in the use of mother tongue, local language, regional language as a medium of instruction, at least till grade 5 and beyond also. It is at the flexible stage. Then Sanskrit will be offered. We know that it is our pride language, rather we will say, though we are, most of us, we are not using it, but Bhavans, we always try to inculcate among the students, try to promote it. So, and higher education as an option for the students, and inclusion of three language formula, this we are hearing it from a long time. So that will be there in this policy implemented. So no language will be imposed on the students, rather students will participate in the fun projects on the languages of India from grade 6 to grade 8. And it will be as a part, like already we have started it in the policy of Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat, like you know that Tripura is been tied with Bihar. So the students living in Tripura, they will study Bihar, their language, their culture, their tradition, and try to adopt it. And the assessment system, there will be a complete change in the assessment system. That summative assessment system will be shifted towards the regular and formative assessment. And all students will take examination grade 3, grade 4, grade 8 conducted, that will be conducted by an appropriate authority. Board examination of 10 and 12 will be continued but designed with holistic development. National Assessment Center, that is PARAC, Performance Assessment Review and Analysis of Knowledge for Holistic Development, will be set up as a standard setting body. So assessment will be more competency based, promoting learning and development, and will test higher order skill rather than testing the rote learning. So students will be able to analyze, go for critical thinking and the conceptual clarity. So, and equitable and inclusion education, inclusive education. So this is very beautiful part. The main focus of the policy here is that no child should lose the opportunity to learn and excel for birth and background. That I have taken birth in a poor family, so I will not get this opportunity of education, will be removed, will be tried to remove, and special emphasis will be given on socially and economically disadvantaged group, for which gender inclusion fund, special education zones will be set up, and children with disability will also be taken care of. They can fully participate in the regular schools. And states will establish Bal Bhavan as a special daytime boarding school. So teacher recruitment here, as a principal, I'm always facing this problem, because till now, what we are getting teachers by chance, not by choice. So I hope that our young generation, beforehand only, they will decide that what they want to do, they want to become a teacher, then they should start preparing to become a teacher like they start preparing to become an engineer or a doctor. So this concept that apart from becoming an engineer, doctor, lawyer or professor, we can do many more things. There are many more options. And teaching is really a noble profession. So that concept should come to their mind. Because, you know, I can tell you a small example here also, that I know a person whom we have asked that, what is your son doing? He said that he did not got any job and he is going to a nearby school and teaching. Now imagine that this was the system which was going on, that teacher's profession was, job is not considered as a job by his parents. So I'm not telling the whole society is thinking like that, but that mindset, I hope it will be changed, because teacher will be recruited through a transparent process. Promotion will be on merit basis. If you have come to teach, you do justice to your profession, do justice towards your student, and develop the zeal inside you that I need to teach, and every class is my first class. So National Professional Standard for Teacher will be developed by NCTE by 2020. And school governance, school can be organized into complexes and clusters, which will be the basic unit of governance. And, there will be proper infrastructure, because all the schools will be in complexes and clusters. So they will be catering each other. Academic libraries, strong professional teaching community will be there. And where the, you know, experienced people from various fields will be involved, those who will be continuously guiding this professional community, that how to teach and how to enrich the complete teaching learning process. Now, standard setting, that is standard setting and accreditation for the school education, and independent state school standard authority will be set up for the policy making and regulation and academic matter, both by the states and the UTs. Transparent self-disclosure, till now there is a disclosure, but that will be much more transparent, which will be set up by the state school standard authority. And SCRT will develop a school quality assessment and accreditation. So, which is very essential because the schools are running, but whether the schools are running up to the mark, that is very much required. And time to time assessment, like we assess the children, the schools and teachers need to be assessed so that they can, you know, improve themselves and try to give their best. So this is the timeline of the implementation of the project 2021-22, that is the formulation of the curricular framework, school education as well as teacher education. 22-23, common guiding setup for the professional standard of the teachers. and 25-26 attaining universal foundational literacy and numeracy up to grade 3. And in school complexes will be developed, and at least 50% learners will come up. 29-30 universal provision. As I am running short of time, I hope that I could finish the presentation in time. It's only a few minutes left, sir. So 29-30 universal provision for the quality early child development care. Teachers' education, that is education, will gradually move into multidisciplinary colleges and universities. And with minimum degree qualification, 4 years, be it only educationally sound, multidisciplinary and integrated teacher education program shall be enforced. And all TEIs will be converted into multidisciplinary institutes. And by 1940, the policy is fully operational following his comprehensive review to be undertaken. So at last, I will only say that the change that is going to happen in the field of education, if properly implemented by the stakeholders, will bring a revolution in the world of education. And the aim to transform India into a vibrant knowledge society and a global knowledge superpower will be a reality, with a hope that 21st century will really bring out the unique capabilities of each future child. I conclude. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, madam. We enjoyed your lecture. It was inclusive, energetic, I must say, and then thoughtful and thorough. Thank you very much for your
thank you.
Here.
I hope that I'll be able to, come up with the faith that you have kept on me.
Yeah. It was all right. Perfectly all right.
Give me two less time.
Yeah, perfectly all right. Thank you very much. And today we are celebrating the birthday of Maharaja Bir Bikram Kishore Manikya Bahadur in our state.
Yes.
And for the first time in our state, the state government has declared a holiday. Who was a visionary? Who was a progressive king? Who visualized Tripura as a power to reckon with? And we are following in the same path today. We are actually visualizing a better India, a vibrant India, as you are telling all the time. So thank you very much for coming here and giving your lecture. We really enjoyed it. It was excellent. Thank you, madam. And right now, we'll be proceeding to our next speaker, who is Dr. Anup Kumar De, presently working as head of the department in the Department of English, Assam University, Difu campus. Anup Kumar De, he is busy in his research publications. A lot of publications we have got from him, and in many well-reputed international journals, as well as edited books he has got. So he is also associated with the Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysore, as a nominee of the Minister of Human Resource Development, Government of India. So Dr. Anup Kumar De, who is presently working as head of the department in Department of English, Difu campus, he is now with us, and there might be some sort of problem with the connectivity, but anyway, we have got him. Welcome to the podium. Welcome to you. Who is a very good friend of mine. Over to you right now. He will be highlighting the policies implemented in colleges, universities, and especially in research areas. Over to you, Dr. De.
Thank you, Surajit, and good evening, everyone. Rather, I should say good morning, because it's a new morning for Indian education sector. And I'm not sure whether I'd be able to present my things uninterruptedly, because there is a network issue here. So I'm not sure, but I think participants will bear with me. Now, a lot of things are already said on new education policy. Our respected higher education minister of Tripura, he has already spoken of the policy, different aspects of policy, how this new policy will bring a kind of change in the education scenario of India. So I'll focus on, and then Madam has also talked about how education, this new national education policy will affect the secondary education. So my focus would be primarily on specifically on the aspects of how this particular policy, how this education, a national education policy prepares a roadmap for the promotion of Indian languages, arts and culture. So this would be my focus area, and in between I'll also focus on how the universities and education institutions, higher education institutions will cope up with the system. Now, talking about the goals of national education policy, the primary goal is to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all by 2030. Actually, this was highlighted by the goal set up in 2015. When this new government came into power. So after that, this particular roadmap was, this particular statement was declared that that India aims at ensuring inclusive and equitable quality education and promotion of lifelong learning opportunities for all by 2030. And when we analyze this particular policy, national education policy, again we will find that the goal is the same and deadline is also the same, that by 2030 lot of things will happen. Now it addresses many growing development imperatives of our country, because this country is a new country, is a young country. We all know that majority chunk of population of this country comes from this particular age group. So they have their own development and aspirations, and this particular national education policy aims at fulfilling their dreams. So it, in the process, it aims at revisioning and revamping of all the aspects of education structure. Now it also talks about regulation and governance. It talks about creating a new system, and that should be aligned with the new aspirational goals of the 21st century education. And it should be based on India's tradition and value system. That is, this is very important aspect, because Honorable Prime Minister of India has already stated when he addressed the nation just after the adoption of this particular national education policy, he said that every nation has a education policy of its own, which aims at keeping its own tradition and heritage, and in the process aspires for a future which is very dynamic, which is very prosperous. But its feet is always there on its tradition and culture. So if we analyze the previous policies, we find that this particular statement was also there, but at the implementation level, that was not executed properly. So this new National Education Policy 2020, it aims at giving a prosperous future to the new generation, but at the same time, keeping their feet on the tradition of India. Now, specific emphasis of this National Education Policy is on the development of the creative potential of each and every individual. Now, this policy, it covers the population of more than 65% of India. So it's in the process, if the majority, you can say, chunk of India's population are directly or indirectly affected by this particular policy. So this specific emphasis of this national education policy is to develop the creative potential of each individual, so that each individual can prosper in his or her own direction and this policy should have something to help him or her in fulfilling his or her own dream. It was not something called, it is not something like stereotyping, that a particular structured type of education would be there and the students should move in that, within that particular structure. And so long we have experienced this particular thing. Now, talking about Indian culture, because this particular policy was based on Indian values and culture. So we all know that Indian culture is very rich and very powerful culture, and it produced, it's an outcome of several thousand years of, you can say, traditions. So it has its own intricacies, it has its own customs, it has its own works of literature, and this new education policy addresses that particular aspect also. And India is always termed as Incredible India, and the new tourism slogan is also Incredible India. Now, talking about the promotion of Indian arts and culture, this arts, we all know that arts forms a major medium for imparting culture. And the arts, besides strengthening our cultural identity, awareness, and uplifting societies, are well known to enhance cognitive and creative abilities in individuals and increase individual happiness. Now, an important aspect which is there in this national education policy is not to focus solely on the cognitive development of the student, not to develop only the cognitive domain of the student, but at the same time it also addresses the emotive side, this the emotional development. And that's why in this education policy we found that along with science and engineering, along with health and other sectors, other professional sectors, maximum emphasis is also given on humanities and social science subjects and disciplines. So this is primarily because this new national education policy, it gives importance to the emotional aspects of children, because its main purpose is to develop a human being into its completeness. So then language, coming to language, you all know that language is inextricably linked to art and culture, because art and culture expresses its you can say expresses through language in most effective way. Language becomes the medium to express art and culture. Now that's why language is very important, and it, culture is seeded in our languages. Now, when we want to study a particular culture, a particular tradition, a particular nation, we usually
Sir, we are having some sort of problems with the connectivity with Dr. Day. And he also earlier had told that there were connectivity problems with him. So please bear with us, and we are amid the interesting lecture series, which is captioned as Understanding National Education Policy 2020, an evening with the intellectuals. We have heard so far the Honorable Education Minister, and yes, Dr. De is back. He had some sort of problems with the connectivity. Please bear with us. And he was talking about the Indian culture, arts, the importance of Indian arts, how the national education policy is providing emphasis on the promotion of our Indian culture and tradition. And Dr. De will be there shortly. Please bear with us, and we are trying to connect with him once again. So far, we have heard the Honorable Minister and other people. And so.
Teaching and learning of Indian languages need to be integrated with school and higher education at every level. This is very important, and that's why in chapter 4 of this particular national education policy, it is categorically mentioned that the elementary education should be imparted through mother tongue. So the emphasis is given on mother tongue. Stage, and then also kind of so that even the higher Indian language, that kind of endeavor was there. Now, a language can remain relevant and vibrant if we find high quality learning and print material in that particular language. Now, suppose if we are pursuing in some stages of India, now if we don't have enough high quality materials in this language, considerable number of textbooks, considerable number of workbooks, videos, plays, poems, then this language cannot prosper. So now it's a kind of challenge to other Indian languages also, because there are some languages, not some, rather a good chunk of languages which are at the margin and they are on the verge of extinction. So if that language has to remain as relevant or vibrant, then there should be high quality learning and print materials, including creative literature. Now and then It should be also open to accept the influences from other languages also. This is very important, and this is also you can say stated in this particular education policy. Now, how to foster these languages, arts, and cultures in school? And this is clearly, I have already told you in chapter 4 of NEP 2020, it is clearly mentioned that greater emphasis on music, arts and craft throughout all levels of school, it is given. And then the early implementation of the three language formula to promote multilingualism. So this is also there in this particular policy. And as Madam has just now pointed out that it is always emphasized that the basic things of any subject should be taught in mother tongue, so that they can understand properly. Even if it is the medium of instruction is English or any other language, but the things should be clarified to them in their mother tongue. So when they appropriate it, only then they can make it useful in their own lives, implement it in their own lives. Otherwise, it should be something that they will learn something, and in their practical life there won't be any implication, any implementation of that thing. So that's why the teaching, this education policy says that at home, teaching in the home or local language wherever is possible. It's safe. Then there should be some experimentation also in local languages and in the field of art and culture also. The emphasis is given that the student should be well acquainted with the tradition, with the society in which he or she is living. And for that reason, the hiring of outstanding local artisans, writers, craftspersons, and all these things, all these people, they should be involved with schools, and they should also engaged as instructors in different subjects. And if we want to engage them as instructors, because from 8th standard onwards there is a provision of vocational education. Now if we want to implement vocational education properly, then we have to engage these local artisans, local carpenters, local craftsperson, and we cannot expect that they would speak in a language which is not very, in which they are not so comfortable. So for that reason also, local language is important. Now, then again, another very important aspect is the inclusion of traditional Indian knowledge system, including tribal and other knowledge system in the curriculum. This is very important because when we talk of different aspects in our education, we found that this is not so connected with the society in which the students are living. So I give you one example. Now a child of Nagaland or any such tribe, hill states, may ask this question when he or she will read, "Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water." Now he or she may ask the question that they normally go down the hill to fetch the pail of water. So how come they have to go up the hill? So this is something they cannot relate with their own life. So this seems, this appears to be something alien to them. So even at that particular level also, we are teaching them something through rhymes which they cannot feel affinity with their own life, own system, own surrounding. So it should be in that manner. So the local or traditional Indian knowledge system, tribal knowledge system, should be incorporated in the curriculum. Now the most important thing, if we are talking of promotion of Indian languages, that the most important aspect will obviously come the teachers and the faculties. Now information understanding mission.
Hello, we are extremely sorry that the connection is poor from Dr. Rudde's lecture. It is interrupted for connectivity issue. Since we are also running short of time for this thing. Dr. Mukti is once again here, and hopefully he can connect better this time because there's a problem from his end. He was basically talking about the promotion of Indian arts and culture. How his national education policy is trying to incorporate. They'll be incorporating our own tradition, our own culture, our own local flavor in the coming days, in the curriculum, in the syllabus. And they normally, Dr. Day wants to say that it would be appropriate that somebody who is learning the rhyme Jack and Jill went up the hill is not basically suitable for an Indian student, Indian kid who cannot relate with this sort of scenarios, even associated with rhyme. So this has to be changed. And national
and for that reason, national research foundation would be constituted. And this national research foundation also take care of this aspect, that is Indian languages. That research may also be conducted in Indian languages. It should not be restricted only to English or some or one or two other languages, but it should develop a kind of potentiality so that researchers can pursue their researches in Indian languages also. And that's why every higher education institutions, they are expected to join that program of keeping artists in residence, just like writers in residence. So in that way, artists in residence, and in that way the culture, the art can be promoted, and in that way also languages will also be promoted. Now this is also directly related to GER, general enrollment ratio, because if we promote Indian languages, local languages, we'll find that more and more people will also come up, guardians will also come up to enroll their students in education, and in the process GER will also increase, because we are targeting to achieve 100% GER, gross enrollment ratio, and then to minimize the dropout. Because when we assess the dropout from elementary to secondary education, we find that the dropout is very high, and again from secondary education to higher education, the dropout is higher, and it is something which is very disturbing. That why students are discontinuing, and the surveys and other assessments have brought out this particular point, that the students, they were not allowed to pursue in their local languages, pursue higher education in local languages, and this has created a kind of obstacle, and this has resulted in the high dropouts. So the higher education institutions will encourage and incentivize the use of Indian languages at medium of instruction, and also to promote, also to give bilingual programs. Then high quality programs and degrees in translation interpretation. This is also connected with language, that you cannot prosper or survive without exposed to other languages. If we want to promote our own languages, we cannot keep ourselves shut within a limited periphery, but it should be exposed to other languages also. And the main, you can say, medium through which this language can be exposed to other languages is through translations and interpretation. So for that reason, this national education policy has talked about the promotion in the field of translation and interpretation, and arts and museum, administration, archaeology, artifact conservation, all these things are given importance. And policy, there are some intensive ways suggested. Now, when we talk of Indian languages and promotion of Indian languages, at the same time, we also talk of how the languages, the students can also understand the culture of India, the diverse culture of India. And different programs also, can be implemented. Now, this new education policy talks of a method like that which would promote the students educational type of the students. This was there in earlier education policy also.
Sorry, the connectivity issue.
Undertake educational
tools
and they can understand the culture and language of other parts of the country also. So a kind of mission mode project is initiated and that has to be promoted. Translation and interpretation efforts, all these things I'm running short of time, but this policy talks of the promotion of Indian institution of translation and interpretation, and this is very significant, and through which Indian languages will be exposed to other foreign languages like German or Spanish, Portuguese, and other French, other languages, and in the process, these languages can be developed, and in the process. Employment generation can also happen, and tourism sector can also be developed. Now that then comes the role of Sanskrit, that whether Sanskrit can play a significant role in this particular aspect, because we all know that Indian knowledge tradition is basically treasured through the medium of Sanskrit language. So many of our resources are unexplored because the majority of the research scholars, majority of the academicians, they are not conversant with Sanskrit. So Sanskrit is given promoted. So and that should be this policy says that there should be a kind of endeavor that the scholars of Sanskrit can communicate with the scholars of other disciplines, for example, physics, chemistry, and other things, and which is there in India, which Indian scientists or Indian, you can say, scholars have contributed earlier. There are so many books in Sanskrit language, but these the modern physicians, modern physicists, or modern chemical engineers, they do not know Sanskrit, and they cannot explore the resources which are already there. So a kind of, you can say, endeavor, mutual endeavor is proposed in that particular language, in that particular policy. Other than Sanskrit, there are also provisions for the promotion of other classical languages. So this particular aspect is also there. And B.Ed. course also, this should be promoted. And documentation, this is very important, because a language cannot survive, cannot sustain unless these are documented, and this documentation can happen through various means. It may be through web-based platform or portal or wiki kind of platforms, and these platforms should contain videos, dictionaries, recordings, and other people, and those people, and particularly other people who are the speakers of some endangered languages, and after them, that particular language will extinct. So for those endangered languages, this documentation is more important. And there should be some scholarship schemes also to promote Indian languages. So this is all about my presentation. I don't know to what extent I was audible.
Yes, thank you very much.
Presentation, I'm not sure about that.
Thank you very much, Anup Kumar Dey, for his presentation. It was interrupted. We lost the link in the mid of your lecture. So we also revived could revive this thing. Thank you very much for coming. And it has been an interesting lecture from your end, where you put emphasis on the promotion of our Indian culture, arts, and other things, our literature, and especially how we can, you know, streamline Sanskrit. That was your effort. Thank you very much for coming. And right now, we'll be moving to our next speaker, Dr. Shorit Bhattacharji, who is working as a lecturer in University of Glasgow in Postcolonial Studies. Shorit Bhattacharji is a very known name in the field of English literature there, and where we have kept with him, because of he can provide us a view which is insider as well as outsider, because he has worked in India as well, and right now he's settled in the United Kingdom. So his works, research interests include postcolonial literatures, famine and food security studies, their translation studies, Marxism and literary form also. So Dr. Shorit Bhattacharya's works have been published by publications like Palgrave and other big publication houses. So his co-edited volume on Navarun Bhattacharji is scheduled to be out from Bloomsbury in September 2020. Shorit is a founding co-editor of Shonglap, Journal of Literary and Cultural Inquiry. So we are very fortunate that we have got Shorit Bhattacharji with us, who can put light on national education policy, somebody who is staying outside of our country, but whose heart is in our country. So he can put important inputs in this national education policy. Over to you, Dr. Shorit Bhattacharji. Thank you for coming, and it's over to you right now.
Thank you so much. Just let me know, first of all, am I audible clearly?
Yeah, you're absolutely audible.
Okay, and I was planning not to sort of show any slides as well, because this is a kind of a long program, so it's going to be tiring. So I'm just going to be brief and concise in my talk. But first of all, let me thank you, Dr. Sen, for inviting me over at this very relevant sort of web sort of lecture series, where you have also been able to pull together a number of sort of illustrious personalities. And this is, as you know, it is one sort of, when it started, it was midday in the UK. So I had like some office work, etc. But I have managed to sort of come in and listen to most of the speakers on YouTube, the link that you kindly provided. So thank you so much for organizing this. And I'm sure like it has been a very good and a very sort of useful series for your viewers. So what I'm going to be talking about today is mainly a perspective that, as Dr. Sen has already appropriately sort of brought in, a perspective that I am both sort of aware and familiar with, sort of the Indian education system. And I have grown up, I've done my BA, MA, MPhil in India, and then my PhD in the UK. And then I taught for a year at IIT Roorkee. I was teaching English literature there. And then I came back and joined Glasgow in last year, August. So what I mean to bring into this topic is some sort of a comparative perspective, both as somebody who can talk about in a comparison between the education system in, let's say, Britain, or in that sense, higher education, India, and also something that is very important to my field of interest, that is comparative literature, postcolonial and global comparative literature. So I think by now most of you have already got an understanding that this policy in general, broadly speaking, has many noble intentions. And it's very promising, very grounded. It has holistic, multidisciplinary kind of sort of commitments. And the policies are catered to creating an equitable sort of education. That has been very much there in the 66-page sort of NEP draft that I went through when it just came out, maybe like 30th or 31st of July. And it was very clear that education is being conceived of in a broad, inclusive sense. Okay, and then I was mostly interested, already many of you and people are talking about school education and sort of this 3+5, sort of this new pattern in schooling, which is very helpful. And some of the promises, some of the sort of, you know, accreditation or regulatory frameworks that have been implemented. As somebody who belongs to, let's say, in a higher education studies departments and have interest in these areas, I'd speak more mainly about the higher education part, not in the schooling or the primary education part. There are other experts and already people have spoken about it. So about higher education, I'm going to be focusing mainly on three issues. The first part is, of course, the BA, like the research part, right? From BA, you can step into PhD. Then the second part is about the SEDGE, as in like the social and economic disadvantaged groups and the kind of education that we are thinking about. And the final part is about internationalization. That's where I also am sort of beginning to think like how it's going to be implemented. So one thing is very clear, that this education policy wants to make, a very inclusive and a kind of an education that balances, let's say, a vocational and vocational interests, right? So a vocational isn't like fundamental interests, like English literature. I do English literature, right? So why are you reading English literature, let's say, in Tripura, or you know, in a district, in a tiny village in Tripura, knowing about what Wordsworth wrote about daffodils, right? You would always say, I've never seen daffodils. Why am I even interested in reading about daffodils? So that's a more fundamental area of interest. A literature, we don't read a literature only to know whether we have them in our own precincts. We read them to also have a comparative understanding and also to know how others are writing, and also because English literature has a colonial connection, right? If you are reading French literature or Persian literature or Urdu literature or Bengali literature, you know what kind of comparison I'm talking about. Now, that's the avocational part. You do not necessarily read these things because next day you'll get a job and you will sort of change the world. You read them because it also interests you, and it also gives you the sort of the ability to sit for maybe like comparative exams or move into other branches, such as public sector branches, be it like, you know, be it like sort of civil services, be it like journalism, etc., etc. So English education BA sort of gives you this. Some sort of a platform to move into other branches. Now, that has been, like, I grew up in the late 80s and mostly in the 90s, right? So the kind of education that we have seen, people have already spoken about that, how our education system has not changed, the policies have not changed for a long time. And we grew up with a 3-year BA, 2-year MA, 2-year MPhil, and a 5-year PhD. That's a long course, right? So and then after a PhD, you get into maybe a university post. Now that's a long, and that has been curtailed mostly with interest that are mostly done in the US and the UK and European systems. 4-year BA is something that we do in Scotland, where I'm based here. England or the UK does mostly 3-year BAs, and then 1-year MA, and you get into the PhD. Now, the good or bad things is something that we need to think about, but it actually allows you to get into a research component much faster, right? And we are in a situation right now in 21st century, 2020, where people have begun to post critical comments, maybe on social media, about critical issues. It's not that it's and plenty of people from all over the world are probably able to watch those comments, which are critical, informed, and valuable. So the point is, research comes from that quotient, right? That you want to do something original. You have a critical framework in mind. You want to think about them critically, and then you want to partake and you want to be part of sort of into that kind of a deeper sort of original investigation into something which is new. As Dr. Hajarika was probably talking about how, you can always talk about, do research about the local water bodies, jalashayas, etc. So these are things that you start thinking about. The local can easily be global. I can see your post from here, like thousands of miles away, precisely because of online education and online media. Now, this is these are being implemented, and they have sort of yielded results. The point is, when we move on from 3+1 year BA, even if it is gradation, like, you know, diploma, etc., certificate, diploma, degree, research with a PhD, what is not clear in the document is what is the PhD going to be looking like, going to look like? Is it going to have 2 years of coursework? There is a mention of coursework, but what does the coursework look like? Because now the MPhil has been scrapped. MPhil will not be continued any longer, and MPhil was giving us a foundation for sort of, you know, getting into research. Not that a lot of us wanted MPhil for a long time, because I thought many of these foundations could be brought into MA or sort of, you know, the final year BA, which have been done, thankfully. But MPhil in the last 40-year long system has been giving us you know, sort of science, humanities, and sort of sciences, humanities, and arts and social sciences students a research foundation, right? Like, you are now for the first time doing coursework, writing a thesis that is like 40,000 or 30,000 or 40,000 words long. Now, without that, if you move into from a BA fourth year, which a student is like 21, 22 years old, without giving that particular candidate the amount of knowledge and nurturing that is needed to get into research, it might create more confusion. It might create more tension within somebody who might feel very like wonderful to talk about, I'm doing a PhD, but the platform, the kind of training that one needs to get into a PhD and not feel clueless needs to be done from a BA fourth year level. And that is not very clear. I'm sure like it is going to be a trial and error method. Like, you know, slowly things will be better with time. But that thing was not very clear in the draft. And this is precisely what my perspective in this particular talk is going to be, to find out things which have been there, talked about, but not clearly always, especially in relation to higher studies. Second point that I wanted to talk about here is about the ACDGS, and this is social and economic disadvantaged groups. And what is happening here is that, so before I get into this sort of this topic, this particular aspect, I'd like to once again remind you that, or maybe like, you know, Dr. Shen, that I'm properly audible, right? Because my internet connection has not been very stable in the last 2 days. So just let me. Okay, all right, that's great. Because like that's also one reason that I didn't want to go for slides, because I can't see anything apart from myself and the slides. So so then you go to my next point, which is on ACDGS, spatial social economic disadvantaged groups. Now, again, I'll say that the policy has thought out very clearly about how they're going to be responding to this very important issue of how to educate a population which is socially and economically disadvantaged, right? Many of us are feeling like, many of us might feel that we are ready for some kind of a research work precisely because we have got support from family. Even if we have got like almost very fragile kind of a support in Bengal, or I'm sure in Tripura as well, that whatever I understand about my friends from Tripura, there is a lot of encouragement to do, to go for education. Education as in like, you know, educational or educational sectors, so to say, like, you know, be a teacher, and that's respected kind of a position. Your school teacher, primary school too, is a sort of university professors, the respect is a huge factor, you know, in the same way that you go for civil services. So, because finally what we are doing is we are educating teenagers and sort of younger minds, right? So that's a very important job. That's a very important and sort of a job that demands a lot of care. Now, not many of us, and India is a country, and I'm sure like we do not have to sort of mince words about that. India is a country, is a vast country of socially and economically disadvantaged groups. A country which has a lot of potential and a population that has a lot of potential, but unfortunately, such has been the course of history, such has been the course of production, economy, that a plenty of groups, plenty of sort of population groups will feel sort of, or will go through this situation. Now, how do you bring that in? The point is not that whether it is true or sort of it's a lie. Point is, how do you bring that particular population in? If India has like about 60% or 70% of its population in the poverty zone, or in a zone which is economically disadvantaged, how do you bring that? Do you decide to not give them education? No. So clearly this particular policy has thought about it and has given us some directions, like as to how sort of bring or encourage or bring that particular population in. Now, the point is, it's not that it is fundamentally unprecedented. The previous policy also thought about it. India, when it got independence in 1947, was not an affluent country anyway. So they had to think about how to bring in people from disadvantaged groups. So from the 1966 onwards, the policies that we have heard people talking about, they have thought about that. And, you know, if you remember, midday meals was something that we saw suddenly sort of from maybe like 2007 or something onward. I don't remember exactly when, 2003 or 7, but it was a success. It is the sign of a social welfare policy. The state is a welfare body. It will provide support to its population, which is ailing, which is not being able to sort of, you know, get that support from themselves. So that's the contract that we sign when we vote, or when we sort of tend to become citizens, that we have elected a government that will take care of us. Now, this is something that is also there in this particular, and I'm saying this, that the new education policy is absolutely new when it comes to, I believe, the holistic understanding of arts and sciences, which is fantastic. And I admire that this sort of policy, think about that, because I taught in an IIT, and the IITs, as you know, have humanities and social sciences departments, but they are not always, the sciences, the hard sciences and the humanities are not always talking to each other. And that needs to be there. And that has been probably a spectacular failure of IIT education, that it has been so much oriented towards jobs and towards getting sort of, you know, rather than always an entrepreneurial sort of a culture, innovation culture. So that's great that the government and the educational bodies, and especially people who chair this kind of committees, are thinking so clearly about these. But at the same time, once again, like some of the strategies that have been outlined in the draft about how to bring this particular population in are still at a basic stage. And of course, we can understand that this is not, this is 2020, just the policy is out. It might probably take 5 years, or at least like, you know, 2 to 3 years to even see how this thing is sort of going to, you know, sort of take shape. So my feeling is the kind of point that I saw in that particular draft is to build special education zones, SEZ. Now, this special education zones will provide education and sort of, you know, infrastructure for a population that is SEDG, and for in a way that is helpful for that particular zone, for that particular population to respond. For instance, maybe like bilingual education, maybe like mother tongue education. Now, I mean, like education in mother tongue probably is the best thing that can happen, right? We many of us get alienated precisely because of the language. Sometimes the language, I'm not talking about English here only, when we grow up in India with our own mother tongues and regional languages. I'm talking about even the scientific languages, right? I mean, I read mitochondria in school, and Golgi bodies, etc. When I was reading about those topics from the books, they were so interesting. But the terms, photosynthesis, mitochondria, these are things that might sort of push away a child at the age of 13 or 14 or something, if they are not being taught well. And always, not everybody has got a private tutor to teach these things well enough. So I'm not saying that a translation into Sanskrit of photosynthesis is going to be easy for a population mostly talking in, let's say, state regional languages. So this is something also that we have to think about, that if we're talking about bilingual education, what is going to be the language of education, even for sort of not only the SEZ, is special economic education zones, but also for, in general, the, let's say, more of a mainstream population, or more of a majority population, student population. For instance, I come from Bengal, so and from the northern part of Bengal, close to Siliguri and Alipurduar. So these are districts and sort of territories where, of course, Bengali is the major language, but there might be, you know, Nepali, or there might be Santal, there might be different languages that people talk about. Like, what is going to be, you know, sort of this major language that we speak? And maybe a good number of population is not speaking in Bengali, right? And so assuming that they're being taught in mother tongue is also going to be complicated. So this is something that we want to think about here, that if we want to talk about education in a holistic, inclusive and sustainable manner, then we have to also think about how you know, this is going to be sort of going into some of these a population that we do not always greatly think about, but a population that is key to India's building, right? And a population and something that the draft has definitely given quite a considerable amount of thought on. So this is something that I'm looking forward to. And finally, before closing, I'd like to talk about the final point on internationalization. And this is something that is going to be also a very important step, I believe, for Indian education in the next years. Internationalization is where you are internationalizing your own university. Now, I can tell you one thing, that being in the UK for some time for my PhD and now teaching, that some universities are already international, some Indian universities, I mean. For instance, universities such as BHU, universities such as JNU, DU, or Hyderabad Central University. And I mean, I'm talking about universities, and then there are IITs, IIMs. These are already widely known. Right. If you ask that I'm not saying like everybody knows about them, but there is a significant amount of faculty and student presence of these universities now working in other universities abroad, let's say in international territory. So that will also provide a lot of support to the Indian education departments, that there is already an internationalization happening. And I'm more than happy to be part of this internationalization today. Day before yesterday, I had a talk with the internationalization officer of Glasgow about the strategies that they're going to take in order to internationalize themselves and sort of promote the university, etc., and also to sort of, you know, sort of create connections between Glasgow and Indian universities. And once again, they were asking me, because I'm one of these people who have a sort of, you know, some sort of an understanding clear about how Indian education system works, because I've grown up. So this is going to be bilateral, right? This is going to be something where universities, let's say in the UK, US, Europe, etc., universities which India, the education policy has considered top 100 universities, they are going to be in discussion with university and committees in India. Now, as I can say, this is not going to be a very difficult task. If you think about from the other side, that will India be able to internationalize itself by sending its satellite campuses or establishing campuses outside of India? I think it is. I think India has a number of already world famous universities and institutes which will be known, which will be sort of, you know, interested, which will be interesting for sort of attracting student populations globally. And when I was working in IIT Roorkee, I could see that a number of students from different countries in Africa, in the Middle East, and in Europe come and do their PhD or other works in IIT Roorkee. And I'm sure many of the IITs and national institutes will have that framework already going on. So it's not very difficult. The other side of it, and I think it is not only difficult, it is not sort of not difficult, but also it's something that is very important, that institutes and universities must think about how to sort of, in a sense, bring in population from diverse countries and situations and territories to actually find out the challenges of educating citizens or students in the 21st century. Now, the other side of it, whether universities and institutes will be interested in establishing their campuses in India, again, my understanding is, of course, they will be, precisely because India, there is no dearth of talent, and India is also a particular country where quite a huge amount of student population that goes out to study, to do their undergraduate and postgraduate studies outside. So of course, like, there is always an interest in learning from and sort of graduating from these universities. So I'm sure, like, you know, other universities will also be interested in setting up their campuses in India. But the crux here, the caveat here is, what about fees then? Is it for everyone? Now, this is going to be important here. Like, is an education. I grew up in an education from Presidency College where I paid 75 rupees per month, and then I got an education for the entire 3-year BA. I got probably in 2700 rupees, which is probably nothing in if you're thinking about shopping for Durga Puja, right, or something like that, some kind of a festival. Think about that. In 2700 rupees, I got a world-class education at Presidency, which it enabled me to come this far. Now, this is something you have to also think about, like when you are thinking about bringing world-class education into India or thinking about internationalizing, bringing world-class universities, not only bringing, when you are thinking about making universities world-class in India, how are you going to deal with the factor that who gets into these universities and what are going to be these sort of eligibility criteria? These are things, of course, this will take a long time to formulate these things. And it will take probably 5 to 7 years to even see how the things are shaping, turning out, etc. But as I said in the very beginning, these are all absolutely fantastic, grounded, noble intentions, full of promise. But we need to sit, especially from a higher studies perspective, I'm not talking about primary education, which I think is more grounded than the higher studies right now. For higher studies, and especially for the internationalization part, I think we need to wait to see how this thing finally, because India is a vast country with plenty of universities, colleges, etc., and regulatory frameworks. And it has been a great, in a sense, this policy has been absolutely nailed to bringing them together, to harness the amount of spirit and sort of amount of energy that the education sector in India has. But these are challenges that we are going to be finding out as well in terms of, you know, internationalization as well. So with this, I would like to stop. I would like to conclude my presentation. And once again, I would like to thank Dr. Shane for giving me this sort of opportunity to share some of the observations that I've been thinking about, that I have about this policy. I just hope that some of these observations remain with you and you think about it. And finally, I wish all the best, my country and my fellow citizens, all the best with the education policy. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhattacharya. You have put some very pertinent questions. These are actually crowding our minds also, but we do not know how to handle these sort of questions. Perhaps time will be the best judge. Time will tell us everything. So you have talked about research or things, how it will shape up in future about internationalization. Hopefully this will attract the attention of the concerned authority, because our minister is also there in this panel, so he must have heard your queries, your apprehensions, your doubts, your questions, and hopefully this will be addressed in the days to come. Thank you very much for joining us. It has been engrossing. Your lecture was simply engrossing. We enjoyed every bit of it. And do stay safe as well in this time of pandemic. I wholeheartedly, thank you for coming.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. You have a good day. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, our pleasure. Now we'll be moving to our next speaker, who is IQAC coordinator of Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Debashish Roy Choudhury. We are conducting this international lecture series in collaboration with IQAC, NSM, Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, and he is Mr. Debashish Roy Choudhury, who is a professor of physics chemistry. He is our IQAC convener. Welcome to this webinar, Mr. Roy Choudhury. And it's up to you right now, how will you address the webinar? Thank you very much for coming. It's up to you right now. Please go on.
Very good evening to all. Am I audible? I think I am experiencing some connectivity issues. That's a very good evening to all. Yeah. Am I audible?
Good evening. Yeah, you are perfectly audible.
Okay. So very good evening to all. It's a great privilege for me to say a few words in today's event. It was in mid-May, to be specific on 12th May, that we have in our institutional IQAC meeting, we have resolved that all HODs of our academic departments will be requested to organize webinars during the extended lockdown period on relevant topics. Since then, we have seen a flurry of webinars organized by different departments of the college and powered by a dedicated team of faculty members who have developed themselves a lot and unlocked their hidden potential Today's webinar is a very nice continuation of the efforts on the most relevant topic of national education policy, and most importantly, the first in the nation. So, by an educational institution. So, I like to thank the organizers, and also I like to thank all dignitaries and esteemed resource persons who have spared their valuable time for our webinar today, and hope all participants have learned a lot about the nitty-gritties of the new education policy, and thanks are due to them also for participating. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Roy Chaudhary. And hopefully our IQAC will be, instigating all to do this sort of seminar. Thank you very much for coming, for your kind words for this webinar. Now it's up to my fellow colleague and assistant professor in the Department of English, Nitesh Bhatt Mahavidyalaya, who has been working very hard to make this webinar a success. My sister, Mrs. Patriot De Burma, she'll be giving the vote of thanks to conclude this wonderful session of lectures. Over to you, Patriot. Thank you very much.
Good evening to all the participants and who have joined us on YouTube as well as on StreamYard. I'd like to thank all of you for being here with us uninterruptedly and for patiently bearing with all the nitty-gritties of technical life that we have been associated with since the COVID-19 pandemic. Honorable Principal in Charge of Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Dr. Rita Das Nayak, who is our very beloved madam, who has always been with us in whatever endeavors we have undertaken as a part of the college. I would like to take this privilege to have been asked to propose the vote of thanks on this occasion, and on behalf of the organizing committee of today's one-day international lecture series on understanding national education policy 2020, an evening with the intellectuals, I would like to extend my own hearty vote of thanks to all the honorable delegates, to all the resource persons, our very distinguished speakers who have blessed us with their presence, and who has also taken out their most valuable time out of their busy schedule for gracing their entrusted work of elucidating National Education Policy 2020 and sharing with us their own opinions in a very, very elaborated way. First of all, I would like to share my deep sense of gratitude to our Honorable Minister of Education, Sri Ratan Lal Nath, who is also the Minister for Law, who has been very gracious enough to grace this occasion as one of the resource persons for this international lecture series. I would also like to mention my deep sense of gratitude to the Director of Higher Education, Mr. Saju Wahid A, IIS, for supporting us in all kinds of manner, for even providing us with the technical resource here at RUSA Cell in the Directorate of Higher Education. We thank you very much. And we also thank Avir Dasgupta, who has been a constant help regarding this. Next, I would also like to thank our resource person, Dr. Kiran Hazarika, who is the member of the United Grants Commission, who has delivered a very valuable lecture on National Education Policy 2020. We are also grateful to Mrs. Shapna Shom, the principal of Bhavan State Vidya Mandir, Agartala, for elucidating NEP 2020 to all of us in a very, very vibrant manner. Her deliberation has kept all of us glued from the beginning till the end. Thank you very much. We are also heartily grateful to Dr. Anup Kumar Day, Associate Professor and Head of the Department of English, Assam University, Dipo Campus, for enlightening us on the issue of art, culture, language with regard to the National Education Policy 2020. We're also grateful to Dr. Sorit Bhattacharya, Assistant Professor in the Department of English, University of Glasgow, United Kingdom, for taking out time from his busy schedule to enlighten our participants and all of us regarding the insider and outsider perspective on the new education policy 2020. Thank you very much, sir. We are also thankful to Mr. Devashish Rai Choudhury, the coordinator of IQAC Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, Udaipur, Gomuti Tripura, for his undivided support and for being there for all the planning as well as execution of this international lecture series. And I would also like to thank our organizing secretary of this one-day international lecture series on New Education Policy 2020, Dr. Shrojit Sen, who is also the head of the Department of English, Netaji Subhash Mahavidyalaya, for being the person who has been the main person behind the inspiration as well as the inception of the thought to organize such a valuable intellectual webinar on new national education policy. And last but not least, I would like to thank all our participants who have joined us from across the world for giving us the their time, for giving us their patience in bearing with all, and for getting association with us on the new education policy 2020. From all of us here at Netaji, thank you all very much. And I would also like to announce to all of you, our participants, that we shall be delivering your certificates within 30 days. Thank you very much.